Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Hash Church episode 89. Aren't you glad that I'm adding the number now as the Roman numerals are starting to get just slightly outrageous? So we're going to do our morning ritual here, say hello to everyone in the chat. We've got a nice big chat full going right now, and I'm just going to wait so I can mute. There we go. Boom, boom, shaboom. And then we will invite our panelists in, as always. Great group of guys coming in today. Let me just find the new message. That's not it. Let's get over here. Here we go. Do. Unbelievable that it disappeared. I guess I got to start over here. Let's see if I can't get to Chimera first. Chimera. Oh, I guess I better save the actual. It's not so easy doing this all by yourself when you're not organized. But anyway, I hope everyone's doing wonderful today. I'm going to have to do the entire thing over again as I guess I misplaced it to get everyone invited in. I had such a great group invited in today too. I can never remember. Well, let's get a couple of people in here before 20K in the house. I want to invite Dana Larson in today if he's around, see if he's got anything new happening. Mr. Chris Bennett, our historian, should always come in. And then it's just a matter of figuring it out who else I invited in. I guess I better get that. Flailing over here on Hash Church 89. Why don't we do a little bowl? It's just me, but you know what? I'm ready. We do these hangouts all the time on Facebook Live. We got all sorts of terps. Little tangy, I think we're going to do for this morning. We'll dip it right in there. Cherry AK-47. And let's
Good morning. How are you today, sir?
Oh, I'm doing not too bad. You know, I had a great group of people ready for inviting in today, and somehow the box disappeared when I went to send the message to another friend, and it's a bummer because I got thousands of people on my Facebook, and it's not so easy to invite them in each time. So I wanted to invite a couple of the girls in. I wanted to invite Samantha Elvey in, who we haven't heard from for some time, and yeah, just get that invitation out to everyone, you know.
Yeah. Good morning, Skunkman.
It's afternoon or evening for him.
Yeah, very much evening.
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock, 9 hour difference. Beautiful. Well, we're loose today, you know. We don't really have any conversation planned. I did invite Kevin back in just in case him and Chimera wanted to open up that discussion that they had last week. But otherwise, super loose. We can talk about whatever we want, as always. Put the invitation out. I'm pretty sure it'd be funny if I forgot, like, Todd Mccormick and some of the other people that come in every week. But
That was a great discussion last week. I mean, that was, you know, with the genomics, that was just fascinating to learn and see where people are and see how light years ahead some people are in the spans of looking at cannabis research. We know that, you know, Sam has been doing it for decades as well, but this seems to be taking the genomics to a whole other level.
Yeah, absolutely. I was very impressed. I was obviously slightly bummed in the sense that I was at a show and I was unable to. I didn't want to just be there for the entire Hash Church. I wanted to make sure Tony was there for a while, and then I went back to the booth because the booth was absolutely insane how crazy the booth was at this event. We rocked through 110 packs of terps in less than 2 days. We probably could have sold a couple hundred packs of terps. It was very, very busy. Toronto was very just open-armed and receptive to the terpene Bubbleman Blue River booth. So,
blowing smoke towards the Vatican. I think I will turn on my D-nail first because morning cold dabs in the morning are nothing that I really am looking forward to. So,
Dee, you're here and you're in the morning. So what is it you should be hearing this morning from you?
Well, let's bong rip. Bong rip, mother lovers. Let's
Good
go.
Morning. Good morning, D420K.
Good morning, D. Good morning. Is that a beard controller there?
Yeah, I got I tied it up. It was a little crazy today. It was going this way and that way, so I just tied her up.
I noticed you and Chance almost had no beards in 2012 on your old picture that you posted the other day. Was that 2012 you guys decided to start growing your beards or what?
Well, we've grown them a few times, but that was the time we both had them cut off. When we were in jail together, we grew our beards. When we got out, we cut them, all that kind of shit.
Cool. Well, now, I'm glad you're out of jail growing a beard.
Yeah, it's steady growing the beard. I actually started growing it because I was working on the oil fields doing reclamation work, putting the old leases back to bed, making them like they used to be. And I wasn't allowed to have my beard then because of the H2S gas ceilings on your face and all that stuff because of the safety of it. So I was allowed to grow the beard. Oh, now that I'm not working out in the bush like that, I'm growing it.
Someone says you got a Chris Bennett thing going on with those glasses. Welcome, Todd Mccormick, to the room.
Good morning.
Who's Chris Bennett?
Etienne, Todd, and D420K are already bong ripping. I feel like I should get in the same route. We already have 600 people watching live at 9:06 a.m. on a Sunday morning.
Wow.
So shout out to all of you guys. We couldn't do it without you, obviously. It would be a bunch of guys talking to each other. And not that we don't do that every day, too, but this is fun. So pick
Please
up your...
let the dogs out.
Let's blow that smoke towards the Vatican.
Another one.
Todd's letting the dogs out. Woot, woot, woot.
Who let the dogs out?
That would be someone else, because I'm sitting here talking to you. Did you actually hear that? That's fucked up.
You sound dog tired.
I am tired, actually.
I'm feeling that. Let's talk Jamaica, someone says. Well, I'll tell you one good thing about Jamaica. After all these months, potentially a couple of years now, from the time that it started till the time where we are now, they have finally released these license regulations, the application forms for applying for the licenses, all the different types of licenses, and you can see by the types of licenses that they really covered the gamut. I can kind of really show you guys real quick the selection that they went through. They've got I've got it on my phone here. So the process is the types of licenses that you can get in Jamaica right now are cultivator's license, which there are three different tiers. You've got to cultivate up to 1 acre, which is 4,000 square meters. Of land with ganja for medical, scientific, and therapeutic purposes. It's going to say that at the end of every one of these, so I'm going to avoid that part from now on. Tier 2 license, which is to cultivate between 1 and 5 acres, which is between 4,000 and 20,000 square meters. And then a Tier 3, which I really tend to like, is the cultivate over 5 acres, obviously... That's over 20,000 square meters of land with ganja. And then they go into their processing licenses. They have a Tier 1 for under 200, up to and below 200 square meter space of processing. And then, of course, the Tier 2 is one that is over 200 square meters. We've got transport licenses available for vehicles. And then they're doing retail on the island. And the retail is going to come in the form of pharmacies or dispensaries. They're leaving that open, and that's going to be a place where you can purchase ganja products or sell ganja products, but you can't actually consume them on property. That's going to be called the Herb House. The Herb House are basically the equivalent of the Barcelona clubs. The Herb House will allow you to not only sell and buy ganja products for medical, scientific, and therapeutic purposes, with a space for immediate consumption by consumers, so vapor bar, smoke lounge, etc. So the Herb House, love the name on that, by the way, Jamaica. I think you did well there. The Herb House is obviously going to be what I consider probably one of the most popular of the three methods of distribution. And that brings us to the third method, which is the therapeutic. And so they're going to be allowed to sell the ganja products for medical and scientific and therapeutic purposes as well. Not sure. I mean, obviously, they're going to be able to use those products on hand as well. It'll just be different from the Herb Houses. It'll be more like a spa or a healing center as opposed to a club. And then at the bottom, we have research and development licenses that are available. And they're offering an experimental one, which is undertaking all activities involved in the assessment, study, research, development, and testing of products derived from any part of the cannabis plant, including the analytical services. And then there's an analytical services research and development license as well. So, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 types of licenses you can get with multiple tiers in each one. They're taking this seriously. I really think that they might be going a little bit, you know, I wouldn't say slow, because it's been less than 2 years from start to finish that these regulations have come out, and I haven't really seen anything happen too much faster in the cannabis community, whether it be Uruguay or Canada or America. Seems to move at this sort of slow and steady pace of taking multiple years to get a document in our hands so that we can apply for a license. But
so when can people put seeds in the ground legally under these new auspices?
Well, that's a bit of a gray area, you know, because definitely the second the Jamaican government announced that they were decriminalizing a couple of ounces, I can assure you people put seeds in the ground. Now, legal companies, large companies that have more to lose, they're going to be a little bit more careful. There is on the license page, and Sam had it opened up the other day, where it's, I opened that up as well. There's this guy. So I'm not sure if you guys can see this, but this is how the licensing will happen. From start to finish, you're going to be going through literally 12 milestones to get your license. Now, it's possible that somewhere in the middle there, where they offer applicate undertakes additional initial report done and conditional approval given, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So number 7 right there, you can get conditional approval. I would guess that's where it can happen, but I'm not 100% sure because, hey, I'm learning just like everyone else. I don't really have a back door into the information. I get the information as it is released off of the websites, and I will put that, I have actually put that in the Hash Church group for those of you that want to go look at it and check it out. It's exciting to see that Jamaica's really...
Well, one thing they overlooked, Marcus, we want a resin check or maybe a hash house.
A hash house?
Yeah. In other words, they got an herb house. We want a hash house, Mon.
Yes, Mon. But and I hear you, and I'm not sure if that's one of your hilarious sort of sarcastic jokes or if you're serious.
No, I'm serious.
Okay, well, here's the thing. The herb house and the hash house will be the same. The herb is hash under their definition. They are defining cannabis as any and all parts of the cannabis plant. So your herb house, Sam, will be a hash house.
Well, I guarantee it'll be built out of hash, Mon.
Oh, my God.
That's stack awesome. Them trichomes.
The hashish, the Jamaican gum house.
Hash house.
So they just dropped these in the middle of the night this week, yes? These
They went up on, like, Monday or Tuesday. It was just like, pop. I remember my friend sent it to me, and I was kind of like, where did you get this? Like, is it? Can I share this? And he's like, yeah, of course. I got it off the website. I'm like, oh, okay. Well, shit.
What are the residency requirements? Are there?
There are residency requirements. They definitely want the majority of the company to be controlled and owned by Jamaicans, which I completely understand. Certain things like, you know, if you're the person applying for the grow license in your name, they're going to have that person be a local Jamaican or a person that's been living in Jamaica for 3 years. At least. And so I see that the growers that are going to end up coming to Jamaica will probably be hired as consultants, because there's no way growers from North America, Europe, and all over the world aren't going to be coming to Jamaica to share their knowledge. And obviously Jamaica's not into shutting that knowledge down. The neat thing about Jamaica is pretty much any way it's written, they'll have go-arounds. They'll have ways, like people will read it and go, oh no, like, if you have a record, you can't know now, just a second, if you have a record for particular things, you need to have 5 years free of being in trouble since the day you were charged. If you have a record for certain things, which I believe are drug charges, they have the numbers written down, but I didn't
also
go
fraud. Back.
Yeah, it's 10 years. So if you have a charge for cannabis or something, you have to wait 10 years from the charge before you'd be allowed to be in that position where you could actually be the director on a company. Now, that doesn't mean that you couldn't work for said company in the exact same position without being the director. So there's always ways to make it work, and it seems as though Jamaica's setting it up in a way that really will make it work. We'll know more in the next year when, you know, these companies start executing their plans. In the meantime, Jamaicans are growing more and more herb. I think one of the best things about growing herb in Jamaica under decriminalization or legalization will be the fact that the Jamaicans no longer have to hide. They no longer have to climb mountains. They no longer have to carry hundreds of pounds of shit through the jungle, which I'm telling you is hot as fuck, to get to a safe zone where the police or someone else won't accidentally uncover it. So this is a major, major thing. I mean, to me, it's up there with people like Colton Turner not being allowed to leave Colorado because he uses cannabis medicinally and he could potentially perish if he left for too long and have his Crohn's disease take him out. This is the equivalent of imagine him being able to travel all over the U.S. suddenly with his medicine. That it's a pretty major thing for Jamaicans not to have to hide to grow their herb. To be able to grow next to a road is going to be incredible.
Truthfully, I think it's a big deal for the whole world. I mean, Jamaica's been synonymous with ganja forever, and for them to be taking these steps and saying, fuck the United States, it's stupid laws, and, you know, the United Nations is just as backwards ass, it's great they're taking a step in the right direction. They've been oppressing themselves for how many decades?
They don't have to say fuck the United States anymore. The United States said fuck the United States. Look what Colorado, California, Washington.
Yes.
I mean, come on, 23, 27 states now?
Completely agree. You know, my point is, though, is, you know, for the longest time we heard that the coffee shops in Amsterdam could never go completely legal due to the fact of America's pressure and such. And you know what? You know, America's problem has been democracy. Because if it wasn't for these state initiatives, we would have gotten nowhere with our elected legislators. I mean, a lot of people don't realize when, you know, Dennis Perron brought what became 215 and now, you know, 11362.5 Compassionate, you know, Use Act to California to the ballot, we had failed numerous times to get anywhere with the Republican governor at the time. What the fuck was his name? Gray Davis. And, you know, we got nowhere with these elected politicians who were nothing but lackeys for big business that had big money and big lobbyists and would never listen to us. So the initiative was our last ditch effort. And if it wasn't for the initiatives, we would still be sitting here thumbing our thumbs in California and breaking the law, and I'd probably be doing even a longer sentence than I did.
And that initiative was certainly started as a popular initiative, but what pushed it over the hill and made it on the ballot was the people from the drug policy stepping up and footing the bill when we didn't have enough money.
Well, you know, yes, for sure. I mean, you know, the thing was is that, you know, both Dennis and Jack came from a school of thinking that they could get volunteers to change the world, that, you know, this would be this great hippie movement of, you know, just pure passion. And while that's great and all, you know, this is a big state and you need organization. So when they were failing, DPA did come in with funding, and Chris Conrad and his wife Mickey came in, and they were heroes. You know, they organized the state, they got it together, and we all, you know, we have all this progress. Really, we have to thank them for it, in my opinion.
You know, what's funny is that when Dennis was just about to put this initiative on the ballot, and I told him, you know, it's just a little too liberal, Dennis. You've got to tone it down if you want to guarantee it's going to pass. And he just refused. So up on the ballot it went, and that night I called him and congratulated him and said, I was wrong, you were right.
Well, you know what's funny is my complaint when I got the facts, it was right in 95 before I got busted in Ohio the first time. I was sitting in the San Diego Compassion Club, and when I got the first draft of what is now 215, it didn't even allow for us to distribute medical cannabis to people that were sick. And I thought, how short-sighted is this damn initiative? So I called up to John Entwistle and complained at the time and said, what are you guys doing? You're not even legalizing your own activities. And they were like, well, I know, we know, but we don't want to go too far. So it's funny that, like, you were perceiving it as too liberal, and I was perceiving it as you know, too controlling.
Well, no, I think I saw it after your stuff was added.
No, they never added anything for clubs. I mean, you know, this is why, you know, distribution didn't really take off until SB 420, really. I mean, people like Etienne and PPG were total outlaws up until that regulation. Am I wrong, Etienne?
No, we were, definitely, without a doubt.
I wasn't against it being so open. I was worried that it wouldn't pass because it was too open.
Oh, I understand. You're totally liberal,
right.
Sam.
He was right.
More than anything, we always realized that, I mean, like BPG, with Debian, Don, originally it was gathering any type of information because we were anticipating to be busted within 2 years. So everything that we were doing was actually keeping receipts, actually keeping transaction records. We started to do these things in preparation of a defense in case we went to court. We actually could show that where every dime went, where everything went, that this went to actual patients. So we literally started to build our own, you know, defense of the courts, and against, of course, many of the wishes of our lawyers who were like, you shouldn't be keeping any information or anything. And I was like, wait a second, we're patients. We're serving patients. We want to make sure that we're doing this right. Because of these huge holes in 215, there are no regulations, there are no standards. We have to create them ourselves. And so that's why one of the main issues with Berkeley Patients Group was to be activists on the front line, be proactive, show defense in court. That's why there's patients in the name of Berkeley Patients Group, because there was so much shutdown of information within federal court. We figured that we had to take different steps along the way. So by having patients in the name of the actual business, we knew that when we got to federal court, they would actually have to say our name. They couldn't just say BPG. They would have to say Berkeley Patients Group. So it became a proactive way for our own defense in the end, because we, again, we were illegal. We were not regulated. There was no way to go to the State Board of Equalization and get a certificate. We couldn't pay taxes. These were all things that have since changed in the many years. But early on, it was be anticipated to be busted. And when you're busted, have as much information so that you could hopefully, if administered in court, you could prove it and to show that what we were doing was right. So it was always a direct action to change the laws. It's just they never showed up.
Well, right. I mean, and all it ever, all that law gave us was an affirmative defense. I mean, it never gave us the legalization we thought it would. It never justified our existence as growers or producers or
That's absolutely true, Todd. But what it also did was it changed the approach of the narcotics and police officers. They no longer considered us flies caught on their trap.
And we kept the information, and we showed them, and we invited them in, and we said, come look at what we're doing, you know, which was very kind of crazy if you really think about it. But at the same time, we wanted to, again, prove that everything we were doing was above board in the absence of a law. And since then, we have shown through positive actions and our leadership, others have followed suit and have opened up dispensaries and basically follow our model of actual keeping documentation, everything from beginning all the way to the end. So it's always been a continuous process to shore up the laws because of these vast holes. So with Jamaica going the direction it is, Bubbleman, do you feel these regulations will create holes that have to be filled, or do you think they're pretty solidly filled?
I think it'll be impossible to create something from scratch without holes. However, I would sort of say that Jamaica may have less holes because of the due diligence they chose to do by visiting places like Colorado and California, speaking with people in Canada that were operating LPs. They really had a lot to go on. If you think of, you know, where you were 20 years ago, you couldn't get in touch with different countries that had programs already working, like federal and non-federal. Go talk to the people in Uruguay and the people in Canada, and oh, what's going on in 25 different states in the U.S.? Like, they had so much to access, and it seemed as though they accessed it. It seemed as though, you know, people were coming there and saying, oh, we know what's going on, and they were like, okay, tell us. But they were doing that with everyone.
the whole, every group of people that went there and told them how it was, they just created another little piece of the puzzle till they had this beautiful overview and then created those regulations based on that overview. This is obviously
what they haven't done yet is they haven't shown how they will want the cannabis labeled. In other words, which cannabinoids, what percentage, which terpenoids, if that's important to be added. Also listing the pesticides that can't be used for cultivation. They haven't done anything about that yet.
Yep, these are all things that are going to be created as the agricultural aspects begin, as the processing begins. Like I said, there'll be these little holes that need to be filled. But once again, you know, I have a feeling Jamaica will not limit THC the way other countries have chosen to.
I think they were lucky in that I think they heard prospective problems or problems that other people have had with all their programs, so they're wise to them.
Well, there's also been some movement this week on other levels. Ohio, I do believe, has passed its legislature for medical marijuana, which would make it the 26th state after Louisiana was the 25th state. And Ohio 710 has been talking all week. He's in chat talking about what's happening in West Virginia. There's a bill supposedly in West Virginia. And West Virginia, as well as Louisiana, holds a special place in my heart because I went to college in West Virginia, at Morgantown, West Virginia, at West Virginia University. So I definitely want to see West Virginia take things in a general direction that is more positive. But we saw in Ohio is you don't get personal cultivation again. So we saw sort of the similar situation what happened in Pennsylvania. It continues to happen in the Northeast where you can have, they'll have access and they'll have grows apparently, but you yourself cannot grow your own flowers yet. So things are happening domestically still.
Excellent.
Ohio 710, if you can put up any information regarding the status of West Virginia's status.
He just said, talk about West Virginia. That's the only thing he said so far.
Well, it's a great state, and I learned, you know, what's very fascinating is a lot of Rastas and Jamaicans move to West Virginia because it reminds them of the mountains of Jamaica. And when I was, I had an all-ages club in Morgantown, West Virginia, back in the early 90s, a lot of Rastas were around, and they grew in the hills, and they turned me on to really good herbs. So Jamaican-West Virginia connection, huge, much love.
Did they not have a Blue Mountains in West Virginia?
Similar. It's, you know, it's West Virginia is completely inside the mountains, so it's the only state completely encompassed within the mountains. We always used to joke, if you could stomp West Virginia flat, it would be bigger than Alaska, because it's just very up and very down. And for a kid like myself who's from below sea level, killed my shins for weeks when I was in West Virginia going uphill for the first time. That shit sucked. And winter, that weather, not fun either.
Yeah,
but great herb, good scene, great herb scene in West Virginia. It's always been there. I mean, I got turned on early on, and for the most part, it's just solid people, good growers, good people. They just want to grow their herb and live in peace. You know, that's the reality, just like everybody else.
So it is called the Blue Ridge Mountains, and I said that because in Jamaica they have the Blue Mountain. So it's just interesting that there is that even more of a connection through the mountains. I'm sure the Jamaicans that move there are like, no way, the Blue Mountain Ridge? This is awesome. Beautiful. Hey, welcome Johnny B and Tony V, who were sitting on the outside. I guess for a while there they didn't get the hash church link. I like to make people sweat in the morning just for 5 or 10 minutes, make them think they've... You know, Tony's like, damn, I thought I pissed you off or something. I'm like, dude, are you serious? I'm like holding hash church control over people when they piss me off. Not.
Well, and this morning I felt I did good because you see, Todd, I have cancellation headphones on. I've got my computer set up instead of my laptop. You know, I woke up early. I showered. I ate. I'm like, I'm ready at 9 o'clock. And I'm sitting there and I'm like, oh, there's no link. So I'm in the chat. I'm in the chat, and then Johnny B's on the outside, and I'm like, "Damn, what did we do this morning?" I was like, "I fucked up with the headphones. I get it, but like, I've got them now. I've got the headphones."
Can I just be the first to say, and you sound audibly wonderful? Well, you know, it makes a big difference, and I didn't realize that was going on, so it really does.
It just kills the echo and everything else, so it's good to have you. Good to see you. Johnny, are you sipping out of your new cup that you won, sir?
Yes, it was actually, I won it last year, but I didn't receive it till yesterday. And it was a Canadian Concentrate Open. It was 6 months of competition, all different concentrates.
Oh, yeah.
And Remo called me 3 days before.
Is that coffee?
Yeah, it's a cappuccino. I did a cappuccino.
And it has a dab rig in it?
That's a dabuccino, actually. They call those
dabuccino. Wow.
That's a local blower who makes those. What was his name now? Chris? No.
Skullfish
makes those, yeah. Skullfish was the creator of the dabuccino. We got to shout out Skullfish. He'll be stoked that we shouted him out. I've also got a glass cup here. This mine was made by Corey Cotton.
Very nice.
Mine's not a prize by any means, but it's a nice, beautiful sort of glass, fancy mug, and I love it.
Hey, you know, heady kitchenware is really cool.
All I did was clean the resin, and something I learned from you, of course. So did a little bit of time and dedication, and a good grower, and hey, a good strain, and it was a no-brainer when you take dry sift into a pot and it's cleaned properly. It's by far the most epic out of any kind of concentrate.
Give the shout out to Skunkman Sam, because he was really the inspiration that inspired me, that had me teach you how to make that sift. Then
I've been looking for my headphones for Sam I Am, but I can't find them.
Let's give a shout out to La Mano Negra for collecting the Congolese, passing it on to, I believe, Reefer Man, who eventually got it into Vancouver, and then it went via Green Supreme through, kind of got held on there for a little bit, and then it kind of escaped and got to some other people, and then I gave it to everyone, including Remo, who grew that cut that you cleaned the resin from, Johnny B. So it's connected to our community incredibly, that one.
It was just epic resin. And the flavor and the smell when you walked into the room, it was laughing, and it was just, it's amazing terpenes that come from that Congo, and it's the reason why it wins over and over.
Oh, yeah. It's so good. It's why it needed to be given away. It's just like, it's a tough one to keep something like that just for yourself, when really it's so special. And I would always hear people say, oh, well, I'll give it to them if they deserve it. I'm like, if they deserve it, that seems somewhat judgmental. I think that if you think they don't deserve it, they probably need it the most. Does that make sense?
Well, yeah.
If you think someone doesn't deserve something, meaning they don't deserve it, they're not a nice person, it's like, well, maybe they could use like a nice strain or cultivar like the Congo. Maybe it'll make them happier and nicer. It's worth a shot, anyway. Hey, Johnny B., look, you're right behind me on my wall.
Kindness and showing kindness is kind always.
There we go.
I like that. I like that, Etienne. I just say sharing is caring, but I think I might like what you said better.
We always used to have on the on our booth back when we were volunteering was, we accept donations of any kind. Underlined, 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 underkind. Because kind was an old reference to cannabis, for good cannabis. And so it was, again, how we used lingo to kind of make each other aware, like 420, about what's going on, so that we could understand that, oh, we don't just want weed, we don't want mid, we don't want low grade, we only want kind, please.
Hey, I want to welcome Mark Grisman to the room. Oh, I mean Scialdone.
Mark Grisman, really?
Well, I saw you were at the festival the other day.
Yeah, I was at a festival last week.
I'm a big bluegrass fan as well. You might not know that about me because I don't talk about it much, but I've seen all those guys play countless times and just really love the vibes, and it always brings a little smile to my face when I see you right in there. That 14-year-old, 12-year-old kid on the banjo was slain.
Oh, my God. That kid, G. Rockwell, is just, oh my God, he schooled me on how to play the intro to Scarlet Begonias, which I've been playing for 35 years. But yeah, we were right across the river from West Virginia, the mighty Potomac River that cuts through Cumberland, Maryland, so a lot of good West Virginia folk were out, and we brought a straightener and made a bunch of rosin, and yeah, we were thinking about you guys, Hash Church. But yeah, it was Bluegrass Church. Mark, that guy can play. Oh my God. For a 14-year-old kid, he has so much talent. Oh Lord. G. Rockwell, everyone look him up.
Yeah, I'm telling you, it's worthwhile. The kid really does play ridiculous. It's amazing when people can be that age and just be so unbelievably talented. You know, it's kind of mind-blowing when you think about it.
Sure.
Talk about that youth energy, too, especially for the banjo. You know, he's just like, he's got that young energy that he can just, like, flow out into the banjo. And, well, it's good that you were there making rosin and making sure that the the endocannabinoid systems were getting properly saturated there at the Bluegrass Festival.
Yes, many musicians were brought to the right level of inspiration to contribute.
Yeah, we were talking about West Virginia earlier, and West Virginia is the bluegrass state there along with Kentucky and through there, but I've met some of the most amazing musicians through there because a lot of people didn't grow up with TV. They had to grow up playing things, and so they usually picked up an instrument. Exactly. Even back in Louisiana, I used to, on a Saturday night, this is because we had no television back when I grew up, we used to go around and take CB radios and turn them around to the stations quietly to figure out which channel actually had a family on the porch or jamming, and you could actually find an open channel and listen to your neighbors somewhere in the swamp just jamming for hours, and that was music. That was access.
That puts a smile on my face, Etienne.
It was great when you found something. It really sucked when you didn't find anything, which was more often than not.
Yeah. No doubt. But still, when you found something, that's mining for gold right there.
Well, you could hear something you'd never hear before, and you'd hear talent unlike anything you'd heard. Or, you know, back then it was, what, Hee-Haw, and, you know, that was Lawrence Welk. That was your access. This is pre, you know, this is early 70s. This is before, you know, music television or stuff like that. So, yeah. Gotta love country music, and
I can just point out Lawrence Welk was music television to my grandmother.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah.
It was usually Hee-Haw and Lawrence Welk, right? One followed the other.
Oh my gosh! Yeah, I think Hee-Haw and Lawrence Welk were on different channels, man.
Grand Ole Opry for sure was definitely big there.
I think Mark. Wolfman Jack had more influence on our generation.
Dude, I'm talking about Hee-Haw. That was some quality shit right there. Comedy and killer jamming. That's the thing. Back then, those country musicians were so talented. It was before that new country sort of erupted, which is the auto-tune version of country. Those musicians were incredible.
You know, Lawrence Welk was the Bubbleman before Bubbleman, right?
There we go. Lawrence Welk, the original Bubbleman. Actually, I heard Skunkman Sam created the Bubbleman. I read about it in a magazine. It has to be true.
Wow, that makes perfect sense, man.
Yep.
Well, I had some time left over after creating you, Todd.
I appreciate that. I was a difficult creation. You should see the article that Ben Dronker sent me this morning. There are some serious haters in the industry that, like, hate everyone else in the industry, it seems. Like, I didn't even know where to start. It was, like, a zillion pages long, and he sent it to me, like, what do you think? And I was just like, I can't believe this is what we're up against. I can't believe there's that many people that vehemently oppose legalization and progress so much that they'll just, like, lie about everything that's going on.
Yeah, you called it right there. It's like beyond cognitive dissonance. It's more like
willful lying and manipulation.
Yeah,
cannabis fundamentalism.
Cannabis. Yeah, it's unbelievable.
I think it's shell shock from the years of drug war. People are so fucked up mentally because of it that they fight against the change that would, you know, free them from repression.
But they're so easily manipulated and guided by the agenda that be, you know, like I'm sure the Black Panthers saw the exact same thing. I'm sure every major group that was created that was that alternative, they always go in there and create dissent. They create dissent. That's what they do. And so I can't imagine that they haven't been doing it.
Well, there was COINTELPRO, which was the government's known access point of United States government's point of infiltrating and manipulation. And starting to watch some of these people, I mean, they're just following some of the very same patterns. That's all I'm saying. Infiltrate, lie, willful lie, manipulation, putting out flyers with willful lies and misinformation to change the mind of voters with lies and misinformation. I mean, that is nothing but yellow journalism propaganda.
They basically went after every anti-war group. You know, they tried to destroy them.
Yeah, it's absolutely true. You know, it's funny. I'm actually going to file for my Freedom of Information Act for all the various bureaucracies to see how far back they were poking around me and Jack Herer and trying to figure out what we were up to. I bet you anything it goes all the way back to, you know, when we first started filing initiatives.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure they don't like you doing, don't play with their democracy, you know.
That's part, one of the main reasons cannabis laws were not only created but enforced. It allowed them to go after the people they didn't like or want in our country.
And they could use lies and manipulation at will and are legally allowed to lie.
You're a drug user. It doesn't matter.
Right.
You know, well, drug user for the longest time was, you know, just such a... I had a cop call me a doper once. You doper. And honestly, it was like... I guess it, what hit me was the you know, because it was just so rude, you know, and I was just like, damn, you know, like, now I know how it feels. Jesus. But, yeah, there's a lot of bigotry against us even now, you know.
Dude, you know, while we're talking about this, Smash Extracts said, or by stifling a new extraction process. And I'm like, what are you talking about? He's been asking me to get Chris from the Clear to come in here and talk about the Baroni for 4 weeks. So I invited Chris, and Chris just didn't talk about the Baroni. I didn't ask him not to talk about it. He felt he didn't want to shamelessly plug himself. So then Smash went on for two more straight weeks about how we need to invite him in to talk about the liquid nitrogen and the Baroni and this. And I was like, I'll invite him in next week for the special hash episode. So he just basically went on the hate boat and said that I'm trying to stifle Chris's liquid nitrogen method, because I haven't invited him into Hash Church fast enough to talk about it. And I did take personal offense and booted his ass out of the chat room.
It's funny because you were telling me that I might find something like this really interesting. And I think what we can each do is, starting with me, we'll each take a half an hour to promote ourselves. And that way, you know, he'll feel right at home next time.
I mean, the bottom line is Chris is invited in. I want him to come talk about his liquid nitrogen, but all that guy Smash has offered to the room in 4 weeks is get Chris in to talk about liquid nitrogen. Get Chris in to talk about liquid nitrogen. It's like, bro, okay, I heard you. I got it. We're going to get Chris in. We love Chris. He's a good guy. He can come in and talk about it, but holy shit, do not try to control the chat room, and definitely do not call me out for trying to stifle anyone's process. That shit right there is a great way to get yourself bumped.
You got me interested. I want some liquid nitrogen right now.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm hearing it. Anyway.
I want some too.
That's beyond fresh frozen.
Drink up.
Drink up. Dude, I'm not trying to stifle anyone's shit. That's the bottom line. When people call me out for that, I'm like, whoa, what do you think Hash Church is about? This is just for sharing information. We have no... The fact that people think we gain from the information we share is absolutely ridiculous. Like, we're out here just gaining from coming on Hash Church every week. It's a shared knowledge. I enjoy listening to the people in chat. They ask wonderful questions often. They lead the conversation in a great way. And every once in a while, you know, a conversation gets erupted in Hash Church that is... It is...
Bubbleman. Bubbleman. Yeah. Take a bong hit. Take a bong rip.
And Mark, I'd be happy happy to hear about his frozen gas extraction method. That sounds really interesting to me.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm not against it. I'm just saying, if you're in the chat and you want us to do something, the professional way to do it is to send me an email, not go over and over and over again in the chat, and then actually turn to aggression and start attacking. Not cool. Yes, I'm venting. Bubble Man's venting.
Yeah, he wanted you to notice it. You did.
Well, I noticed it. Job accomplished.
Oh, it's always nice on a happy Sunday.
So what are you smoking on today, Mr. Bubbleman, or what are you going to toke on?
I just put some glacial melts in my bowl, some Tangy 90 micron.
Tangy. I'm smoking some Congo Sift. It's really got me buzzing.
Shout out to Glacial Melts. They made some nice product and kicked us down some... They kicked us down a lot of shit in Toronto.
Took the words right out of my mouth. I'm going to say that Tangy from those guys and the chem was so epic. Yeah, thank you, because...
I got the chem right here. You must have smoked...
All of it.
All of it?
It's my favorite. I love chem. That's one of my favorite strains. And I scraped the rest of that yesterday, and then I went over and saw Remo, and he had a little bit to scrape too.
Yes,
it's
they were
nice tasting. They did a good job. And I like how they put it in the bigger jars and kind of and make it really thin than putting it in small jars and having it thick that way. What's your thoughts on that? Just on the presentation in that jar, it was easier for me to actually get it out. It didn't butter up as quick.
Sorry, just replying to people in chat. There's people upset with my orneriness. I had to apologize for my orneriness. But, hey, sometimes the director's got to be a dick, right, Tony?
Sometimes that has to happen.
Sometimes the boss has to boss, but as I say, I've never fired anyone. They fired themselves. We just have to go through the motions now.
There you
bon
go.
I'll be back.
D-Nellen. 825 people watching right now on the Sunday afternoon. #Church89. So here's something I was going to lay on you guys, and it goes right back to Chris, actually, because I'm absolutely inviting him in next week to share his information, as well as I wanted to get Tony in the Bubbleman Blue River Prana Lab to show a little bit of what's going on over there. I want to make episode 90, which is next week, another hash spectacular episode. I really want to focus on hash and hash people. I'm going to invite a variety of people in once again. Hopefully we won't get particular people jumping in without invitations. We really do hope that if you get an invitation, you don't send it to anyone. But yeah, you know, we'll start a link in the Hash Church group, and if anyone has any suggestions as to who should come in for the 90 micron episode, it's episode 90, which represents the black bag, the 90 micron bag for anyone that's ever made bubble, definitely up there in quality. And something cool about the episode 73, Hash Church episode, that's got like 25 or 30,000 views right now. It's one of the ones that the most people have watched. So I suspect if we do 90 properly, we could have a real nice show. So keep panelists, keep your ears open for next week as to who we should get in for that and what we can share, and really just get as much information as possible about hash making that can help people. That's kind of what I want to make the episode, and stories and beautiful pieces of hash. Maybe we'll get the West Coast guys in making hash. It'd be nice to just have a full, yeah, Frenchie would be great. Cuban's definitely at the top of the invite list. Yeah, nice hash episode. It'd be great.
I haven't hash all this week now. I haven't made hash in a while. I haven't pulled any bags since surgery, so it's time to make hash. That's what I'm going to do. Inspiration, episode 90.
I'll be making hash all night tonight from 6 on till I'm done, probably till fucking 4 or 5 a.m., me and my bro. And we'll be having some apple pie moonshine at the same time just to warm up a bit. It's cold.
Ooh, that apple pie moonshine will get off your teeth.
Yes.
Reinhardt would be a cool invite. He's very private, though. I'm not sure he would come in, but he's definitely got his own information for sure. He'd be interesting. I put the invite out to him for sure.
Tell Reinhardt that he can come in and have the camera just aimed at his extractor machine.
Yeah, I mean, he could, for that matter. I would like to invite anyone that has, you know. I mean, geez, it would just, yeah. Anyone that you guys can think of that would make an exceptional hash episode, You know, people that you think are synonymous with hash, people that have affected the world of hash.
And did I tell you what happened about Rob contacting Neville and asking him about who started, who gave him the idea?
No. Did he talk to Neville?
Rob was in Australia. He contacted Neville by email.
Wow.
Asked him. And, okay, for a background, Rob and I showed up at Neville's house about 5 days after this unnamed American had showed him this method
of grinding
it up with the coffee grinder or a spice grinder or whatever, and then put it in water and the water presses. Okay, so we showed up 5 days later, and he told us the name of the American, and he said, you know, this is how he showed me, and blah, blah, blah. So we were, you know, lightweightly impressed. But the end effect of it all was that when Rob just contacted him last month in Australia, Neville denied that anybody had ever showed him, and he says he invented it.
That's awesome.
And we know that's not true because we were there 5 days later, and he was on and on about this guy, but he had already left. So
the bottom line is, you told me that story 20 years ago or a little bit less, and there's no agenda or reason for you to lie. You were like, yeah, this is an unknown American told Neville. Neville told us. We played around.
It was both of us. We were both there, both me and Rob.
Yeah. Sadhu Sam's water extraction.
Class. It's really a shame because I'm always, for some reason, the name Mike sticks in my head. I think it's an American grower who came there to buy seeds from him named Mike, but I wouldn't bet my soul on it.
Right. Yeah, so many
of them. Don't even say that, because now every asshole named Mike who's ever fucking made out the move, I'm that guy.
Yeah, that's right. I'm American Mike.
Go back to you. I don't remember. That was much more accurate.
I showed Neville. It's a cool part of the history regardless, and it is an intricate part of the history because, you know, from my perspective, it goes that unknown American to Neville to you and Rob, you know, somewhere between 88... And 97, Reinhardt came into play with a machine instead of just, you know, he stepped it up a little bit. And then literally less than a year after he released that machine, Mark Rose had named and created the isolator bags. Eldon really kind of invented them. Mila sold them. That was the trio of the original water hash bags. I came in about 6 or 7 months later and wanted to try and sell those bags, and less than a year later was selling bubble bags. And it's kind of why, in the end, when people were like, oh, why did you end up making a deal with the patent guy? And because I got litigated. I got sued for years for selling this product, and at first I was like, fuck that, I'm just selling a product. And as I learned the story, I realized, you know, these bags would have never probably existed had it not been for... It was his machine that they looked at and copied and made the bags from. And so I just felt like, you know, it was a great business decision, and it was a morally and ethically correct decision from my perspective to work out the deal, pay for the patent so that all of the bags I ever sold were paid for and the patent was covered.
What did Eldon get for his idea?
Eldon was supposed to get 5% from the isolator company, but years later, just not too long before he passed away, he said he never had ever been paid a penny.
Yeah, I would have been shocked and surprised if he ever got a penny.
No, he never got one.
Eldon was a friend of mine from 1960.
That's why I know.
I knew him in Hollywood.
Exactly. So for me, the only thing I was able to really give Eldon back then was like I always gave him his ticket to Legends. And that was, I bought my own ticket to Legends, but I always kicked Eldon down. That was back in the early days of my company when I hadn't sold barely any bags and only just knew the story. It was, you know, back in the beginning of what was that, 13, 14 years ago we've been doing Legends of Hash for now?
Yep, the last one I think was number 12. But we also did one down in Barcelona. Eldon was also one of the first hash oil manufacturers in Nepal back in the early 70s.
Yes, and in fact, it was Eldon's hash oil that I smoked with Rob Clark when Hillary Black brought Rob to my house in like 96 or 97 in Vancouver when I was living on the water there, I had this Nepali hash oil. And Rob was like, oh, that dirty, dirty, nasty Nepali, I'll smoke it, whatever. You know, Rob will just, he's like, I'll smoke it. But it was probably not the cleanest stuff back then.
Eldon has a tendency to go for the cheaper product and then try to make something good out of it.
Yeah. Well, he definitely, you know, he did. If he was alive today, I would 100% invite him on Hash Church to tell stories, because I'm sure he's got some good ones.
Absolutely. Because in 65, he was a psychedelic wizard and then moved to Nepal for years and years and years until I think they finally kicked him out.
They did kick him out of Nepal. He got kicked out of Nepal. Yeah. Shout out to Eldon. Raise your chalices, light your joints, take a dab for Eldon.
It's a small world, and it's an even smaller cannabis world.
He's a psychedelic wizard. He's literally the inventor of water hash bags.
So, and I had this in my hand as you said that. I'm not gonna lie.
Shout him out. Puff him down. Got your crystal. Dude, K. Morrow is always in. He has to know that he's invited to Hash Church every week. We'd hold a seat for Kenny, legitimately.
Wait a minute. I thought we only had people on Hash Church that were really serious about hashish.
Oh, my God.
I'm just fucking with Kenny.
I know. It doesn't get much more serious than that.
No, he's a serious, serious aficionado.
Yeah.
And researcher.
So let's raise our cup to Kay as well. We'll raise our cup to one past legend and one surviving legend. I raise my cup to both of you guys here on Hash Church. Yes, you do. The group says, we love Kenny. A patient's episode to discuss medicating more specifically. Patient's episode is a great idea. Because although I love the interview style of like one-on-one or two-on-one, you know, getting a person really to tell their story, there's something about getting five or six or seven people telling their story sort of simultaneously back and forth, and the way that weaves a real beautiful tapestry of what we're practicing here on Hash Church, radical openness.
But how it crosses, you know, socioeconomic boundaries and different conditions and different, you know, I mean, you've got two patients here, myself, Todd, and I, you know, who are always here pretty much.
I'm another patient.
You as well, John?
D420K doesn't talk about it much, but I think he's broken just as many bones as John, literally.
I think he passed me.
He might have passed me.
Aren't you all better, John? You look all better. You can't come on.
I wish I was better, but I'm definitely doing a lot better with the new surgery. But of course,
you look a lot better.
I feel fantastic. It's just like new life for me.
You know, I've seen so many people tell me, "Holy shit, Johnny looks fucking great. He looks like he gained 6 years on his fucking life, man, back." Like, Johnny has made a huge difference from that operation, man. Good on you, Johnny.
Well, thanks, guys. I mean, everybody's there's always supporting me and being behind me with my use and talking about patient use and what I use for my pain and, you know, before and after. It's really honoring to just be able to experience what I went through, be able to share it with everybody, and be able to talk about my experiences and stuff with everybody here. It feels great. It feels humbling too. I mean, I appreciate everybody in the industry and all the people that support one another, and it's really good to see how the industry and the people come together. And really, it's just awesome to be on that same vibe and wavelength with everybody, and you feel that with the events we all get involved with and how we all come together as a big family. And it was great to see you at our first event, yeah, and it was awesome. It was like huge happy family. It was awesome.
It was amazing. I sure felt the love, that's for sure. Toronto fucking rocks. I can't wait to go back there. And as far as bones that have been broken, I've got, I broke my back, crushed 3 vertebrae, lost 1.5 inches of height. I broke my neck a year later. I've broke my jaw. I've got steel both sides of my face. I've broke my wrist. My hands have been just destroyed from growing up in Prince George and playing hard and rough and tough. And broke my arm a couple times, and I fractured my leg going down a set of waterfalls when I was a kid on a tube that I thought I was brave enough to do. But, yeah, and lots of stretch and hurt and injuries, but I'm good. Did lots of pretty much 2 years of straight physiotherapy after the accidents and my breaks and my back and my neck. So when I broke my neck, I was in really good shape from the recovering from my broken back. And then back into the training again. And I'm really lucky to be walking around and riding my motorbike and doing what I get to do when I want. So,
over how long of a period did this happen?
The major breaks, the biggest ones, was about a 3-year period.
Because you have more breaks than the next 5 people I know with breaks, to be honest.
You know, we were sitting at Mark's place one time, a whole bunch of us, and the injuries, the one guy was run completely over with a combine.
You know who that was?
No, who
was
that?
Well, it was hilarious because there was John. And then there was you, who's bigger than John, and then there was my buddy, who was bigger than both of you. That was Romulan. That was Romulan Joe, the original Romulan guy. And you, what was happening was John told his story. Oh, I fell 30 feet, blah blah blah. And then you were like, I got smoked on my motorcycle and dislocated my legs and broke my back and my jaw was. And then Joe was like, oh, yeah, when I was a kid, a tractor rolled over on me, and I broke every bone in my body. And this was at my table, and I shit you not, I swear there was another person, too, who had bad injuries at my table.
Yeah.
We're all talking about our cannabis use, and we're all using concentrates, and, yeah, it was kind of...
Well, you know, all those breaks, everything like that, too, I did actually dislocate both my arms and both my legs out of the hip sockets in a motorcycle accident. I broke my neck on and broke my wrist on. It fucking hurt, man. Oh, my God.
Yeah. And that's what I'm saying. People don't even think you're hurt, dude. No one's ever told me, like, oh, you know, D looks great for having been crushed. No one thinks, like, I'm telling you right now, people in the chat are like, what the fuck?
I don't know. He still looks older than his dad, bro.
He still looks.
I had a dump truck head on.
Now I know why.
The story of my dad, Todd. He's that's my stepdad, but I call him my dad proudly because he has been the guy that's raised me and given me my morals and my man honor type stuff. And he's only 9 years older than me, man.
Well, now that you say that, it makes a lot more sense because for a long time I was thinking, there's no way. But now I realize there was no way.
Here it is. What the fuck? Holy shit. Evil Dean Evil. Evil Dean Evil.
Man, and I thought he was just the epitome of good health and old age. I really did. I was thinking, how could he be double his age? Now I know. Mystery solved. I appreciate you clearing that up, because honestly, it did confund me.
He was smiling pretty hard when you were saying that last time. He was loving it.
Yeah, a decade and some hair dye. I could see this being what the mystery really was.
You got it! You got it! A decade and some hair dye. Oh, that's funny. We're having a nice, relaxed hash church here today. A lot of people in the chat room right now just kind of talking about their own experiences and surgeries and accidents and whatnot. Yeah, it's crazy. You got to be careful out there, people. Thank God for cannabis. You know, having seen that Prince died of a fentanyl overdose, an opioid overdose, what a complete and total, like, just waste and loss of a talented human being. And that's happening, I guess, to hundreds, if not thousands, if not tens of thousands of people around the world. I know here in BC it's really bad. It's a real problem. It's another problem, and it's not a fentanyl problem. It's a prohibition problem.
Well, it's an opiate problem, and you know what? This is one of the reasons why I wholeheartedly support every little inch we can get access-wise to cannabis, because, you know, I had an argument with Don Wirtschafter just the other day about Ohio. Wish you'd passed it, because now it looks like they're not going to have either initiative on the ballot this year. So it's like, there you go. All this bullshit bravado about progress you're going to make, and then given the chance, nothing. Got nothing. Ohio's got nothing. They don't got 6 plants a household. They don't got legal medical use. They got nothing because of
fucking
extortionist.
How
it's not better. Do you know who it's better for? The assholes that are currently making money selling them pot in Ohio. That's who it's better for. People holding their breath, waiting for the sky to fall and pinata to open and freedom everywhere are high. And it sucks because how many people like Prince? I mean, that aren't talented multimillionaires that you're going to hear about, but how many millions of people are having to eat fucking pills and are suffering a similar fate?
Yeah,
it's fuck bad. Pharmaceuticals. I hope everybody gets cannabis.
You know what the fundamental problem is? That these people are concerned about who's going to make the profits from cannabis.
Yes.
And to be perfectly frank and honest, I don't care, especially if you can grow a few plants at home.
Yeah.
100%.
Exactly. This the AMUA is gonna have 6 plants a household, and while I certainly don't think 6 plants is anywhere near enough of anything, I just think it's like opening the door a little, and once that door opens just even an inch or a millimeter, it's done. It's done. It's gonna blow open.
Also, Todd, if you think about it, okay, you can have 6 plants. They're flowering away. Let's say you get 3 kilos from each one. Okay. I'm from California. I could have said 5 kilos, but I didn't want to stretch it. Okay, so 3 kilos from each one. You flower those, you harvest them, and you've got a friend down the street who doesn't grow marijuana but doesn't mind you starting 6 additional ones there. So you immediately put them in. You've got 6 more flowering for 3 months. You cut those. You could do that 4 times a year.
Can I just point something out? Do you know how fucking insane prohibition, it will be pointless for cops to go around. They won't have the resources. They won't have the time in the day to go around and start estimating, are there only 6 plants in everybody's yard? I mean,
they're after that 7th plant, Todd, for sure. And they'll spend billions to catch that one plant.
Yeah, but you know what? See, in the 80s and 90s,
you're obviously right, Todd. Of course.
And I agree with you, you know, but in the 80s and 90s, they could prosecute people like me. Now I think that game is over. There's too many people in the voting pool that will not vote to put people in jail for growing pot or selling pot or smoking pot. Hmm. I think that's the end of prohibition at that. When they can't prosecute us, you know, they really got nothing. Their threats are empty at that point.
David T. says, what the fuck is Sam growing? 3 kilos.
Well, we are talking about only 7 plants, right?
See, this is the thing.
No, that's why I said 7.
7, I love it. You know what, though? Technically, it's still game on for everybody medical because these laws don't change. So if you want to go for it and grow medical, I mean, you're still in the same position you're in now. This is only going to legalize it for people that don't have a medical card and that just don't have a doctor and that just are over 21.
The truth of it is, the vast majority of California marijuana smokers are not medical users.
Well,
even if they are on paper.
You know what, though? Not to be rude. Look, everybody that goes in their doctor's office privately and says, I'm feeling depressed, can I get on Prozac, is a medical user of Prozac in the sense. If they're trying to deal with whatever it is they're dealing with, And I believe that. I truly believe in my heart that there are millions of people in this planet, if not hundreds of millions of people, that just smoke a joint and don't go see their doctor and take a deep breath and go to home and deal with their wife and their kids and their life, and they don't resort to pharmaceutical solutions because they got some herb.
That could well be, Todd, but meanwhile, I still think there's way more recreational smokers than medical smokers. Even if some of those recreational smokers, I mean, if they're smoking a joint after work just to relax and chill out, I mean, you have to cut a line. Is that medical or is that recreational? It's sort of both.
It is sort of both. I completely concur. I think you're absolutely right. And I think that what bothers me is that we, you know,
I think we both agree what we want to do is extend the rights that medical users have to recreational users.
Right. To me, it's almost offensive now that we have to show paperwork to justify smoking a harmless, scientifically proven harmless plant.
It's all medical. It's all recreational. It's cannabis. We should all consume it. It's good for us. We have receptors in our brain that react to it.
Well, we have a full endocannabinoid system that needs to be accessed, that is completely malnourished throughout the entire U.S., you know, and Canada as well, all across the world. So, yes, we need to have access, but, you know, the big fear is, you know, people are starting to talk, well, why should you care about, you know, California, et cetera, et cetera. But somebody brought up a very interesting point, is that we already lost the last one. Okay, so if we lose the second one here in California, then it is going to embolden prosecutors all around the state that will point and say, look, you had two elections and you didn't want it, so it would only definitely get worse. I'm not saying that's the only reason, but it's definitely a logical reason to go, wait a second. And we need to step back and think about that, is if we lose again, that will do nothing but embolden and say, look, there's California, the ninth largest economy in the world. Apparently they don't want it. And it would cause a backlash that none of us want to see.
And the flip side of that is, if it wins, it'll send a message to the entire world.
Yeah. Well, you know, guys, I think there's no way it's not going to win, because there's been all these numbers coming in from all these states around us, and now even the Republicans that were on the fence about it being a good idea fiscally are looking at it with green in their eyes. You know, they want the money for their communities. They want the money for their state. They want to boast about these profits coming from their communities, just like they're watching them come in from Washington and Colorado and the places that have already passed it.
Hmm. Yeah, it'll be interesting to see when it plays out. How long do you guys have for that in California? Like, is it in the next 6 months or something?
It's November. November, the election date.
Yep, the presidential election. So I'll go for our presidential election as well as for states, in that case, California. I do believe Michigan is on as well, and other states for medical. Sans Ohio, apparently. But I know, I think they're going for legalization in Maine as well.
Mm. Well, good on them. Can't wait to see every state on
It'll be the 8th of November this year.
Yep. And Nevada as well is going for it. So there's quite a few states that have things going and ongoing, because I do believe that the initiative, it has to be in, you know, by now to be on the ballot. And it just made the ballot, Alma just made the ballot officially this week, so it will be on the ballot in November. And speaking of, in California here, we got really complacent here lately, and the legislature of California just snuck in a 15% tax on medical cannabis. So it is in passed the Senate by a large majority. Now it's on to the Assembly. If it passes the Assembly, then my patients are going to have to pay nearly 30% in taxes for their medical cannabis now. So already in the city of Berkeley, we pay 2.5% of wholesale, 2.5% retail. Then they have a 9% over-the-counter retail sales. Then you're now going to have a 15% tax. Now, supposedly with AMA, if you're a medical patient, it's going to take away the sales tax. But unfortunately, it's not going to take away this new 15% if it's actually passed. So if you're here in California and you're watching Hash Church, please call your assembly member and tell them you do not want a 15% tax on your medicine. Everyone is going to have to pay it, and the State Board of Equalization, as they stated, is our money. We're only coming to get it, and you're only holding it for us. So unless you want to pay more taxation in California, call your assembly person and tell them, and tell your family members, put it on your Facebook, spread it around, get active, spread your voice quickly, because this is happening this week. If not, you're going to be paying for it.
Out of curiosity, do you know what they plan to spend the raised taxes on?
A lot of that stuff is muddled, as well as they won't tell us until, you know, it's actually passed.
I'm absolutely against it, but I'm kind of curious if they were going to spend it on more drug-sniffing dogs or, you know.
Probably hookers and blow. If I were a betting man.
Well, let's hope people will actually reach out and educate their friends and family members and kind of have them all call assembly members and tell them no, that they don't want this to pass. Otherwise, you don't complain. Mm. We gave you your opportunity to do something, and this is your chance to actually get active and get involved. So look it up, get involved.
It's SB 987.
There it is.
SB 987, 15% medical marijuana tax.
So tell people you do not want that to pass, and you do not support it, and tell them to do not support it. Otherwise, it will pass. So it has a majority in the...
Can you point out there's already a 10% sales tax on the sale of cannabis, and in some places like Berkeley, there's an additional 5% imposed by the locals. So there's already a 15% tax on cannabis in some places already right now. So this will be in addition to that, the state tax and the local Berkeley tax. So this would be a 30% tax. There's nothing else that carries the sin tax. Not alcohol, not tobacco, not sugar water, not nothing. You know, and for them to impose it on us is immoral on every level.
Yeah, it seems like a bit of a money grab. I mean, in reality, what really should be happening is the insurance companies should be covering the majority of these costs, at least when it's for medicine.
The insurance has nothing to do with medical cannabis, and they don't want anything to do with medical cannabis. The last thing they want me to do is become a paper pusher for them. I mean, they've been staunch prohibitionists pushing against us, so there's no way they want to see us take any type of step forward. We don't have the logic intelligence that Canada has where we actually take proper steps. We impede medical access here in the United States at every access point possible, even with an HMO or even with the best coverage. So there is no medical person that I know that comes to me that actually uses any type of insurance. It's still out of pocket. But the higher tax rate is over in, you know, Oakland. I think there's higher in other cities that have actually 10% taxes. San Jose also has a high taxation. But the reality...
the conversation around that we really need to, you know, not just fight for legality, we have to fight for equal rights, because in some ways they don't have a right to do to us what they're not doing to any other industry.
Mm.
That's, I guess, my whole point.
And they feel emboldened too, because we've been the unfortunate, you know, pardon the expression, redheaded stepchild, so it's easy for us to be, you know, the new kicking post. Unfortunately, they're going to tax quite a few businesses out of reality, and it has been a frustration for us, because, again, we were the test case for the state when it came to actually testing, you know, taxing medical cannabis, and we thought it shouldn't be taxed. And now for these politicians to use, as I call them, false prohibition, you know, lenses on their glasses, they're looking at these through these green lenses, thinking that everything is going to stay at this particular taxation and rate based off these prohibition inflation that we exist under currently. And we know as things go, it's only going to come down. So these expectations and projections for these tax windfalls are false out the door, and they're utilizing that as false profit or a false stance to actually say they need to tax us for this reason, when in the end the tax when the prices come down will be useless.
It's not useless in a sense. I mean, if you go back to looking at Jack Herer's own initiative, it back 20 years ago when he wrote it, he put a tax on every ounce of $10. Because at the time, a good ounce of bud was $400, and he thought $10 was not a lot. You know, $160 per pound. And now I'm looking at that thinking, well, when the ounce costs $15, let's say, like Rick Doblin was talking, that $10, it's going to feel like an awful lot of money. You know, and I think that they're not really taking into consideration, you know, the true price drops that we're going to get. And, you know, so this is still something people can fight, this SB 987. It actually passed the Senate, and it goes on to the Assembly now. And I posted the link in Hash Church where people can actually write an email the Senator Mike McGuire that's actually proposing this. And, you know, I think everybody should just demand equal rights. Why are we being treated like any other industry, you know?
In the Netherlands, several of the insurance companies do pay for medical marijuana that you pick up in the apotheek from Bedrocan.
And I believe, according to our constitution, with the way that works with the 10th Amendment, giving states the public safety, they can't actually tax medicine. From what I read before when I was in Colorado looking at it, like, they don't tax medicine. So any tax on actual medicine to a patient is not.
Take it up with the State Board of Equalization. Yeah. I fought it for 7 years, spent nearly ungodly figures of money trying to fight it, even having the former head of the State Board of Equalization as my lead counsel. And in the end, they still said, you're going down, we're going to tax you. I agree with you, and in principle, 100%. But when the tax man says, I'm taking my money and you're going to give it to me, fuck you, you've got no choice.
Yeah, no, I know.
And I think it's different from state to state. Like here in California, 100% orange juice is not taxable, but concentrate orange juice is taxed. So you get into these, you know, and under that I always felt like, well, then whole raw cannabis should not be taxed because it is like the orange. But as soon as you, you know, turn it into hash or make an edible, yeah, it's taxed under the same standards.
Yeah, it might be different in Colorado, Tony, because, again, yeah, it's, as reiterating what Todd says, different states, different state constitutions on what things can do. But, you know, a lot of these other states are looking at, you know, the taxation that states are actually receiving and looking at it, you know, currently. So it'll be interesting to see as each state comes online because, again, we still don't have banks. As much as we do all that, we still don't have banks. And no matter what state you're in, you still don't have a bank. And that's a huge frustration and a huge liability because somebody is going to, the worst case scenario is going to happen. And apparently for the actual laws to change regarding that, and I would hate to see somebody lose their life to actually cause the change of the banking laws because for all these businesses that are out there and are growing and all these other states that are coming online and for us to have absolutely no banks to utilize or to access is only putting us and the public further at risk for the dangers because of the assumption that you know all cash businesses have, even though we do take our professional due diligence as best as we can, it is still a reality that we face every fucking day, and it sucks.
Is credit unions a temporary solution to that problem?
Anybody who's receiving money from the FDIC, good luck. They will call you and tell you no. You can hide as best as you can, and people have, but no. Anything that is federally insured, you cannot get into.
Right, so that's the distinction between a bank and a credit union, right? A credit union isn't necessarily federally insured. The
majority of them are not FDIC.
That's correct, but you can still basically get money into the financial system through financial transactions at a credit union.
But, well, they do, and some try until they actually start going through and ask you and find out what you do, and then they're told to purge. See, what happens is they have the local prosecutors send out letters when they start to see things happen within their jurisdiction, and they send notes to the higher ups in the banks, and then the banks do an internal purging. And when they do the internal purging, they go through to find anybody who has any type of cannabis account and to close them immediately. This has happened time and time again. Again, I've been kicked out of over 30 banks.
Yeah, I've as well, and I could tell you to back up. The Colorado does like a 7% tax on medical side. And the good news is, as regulation comes in, you'll see banks like the credit unions within the state actually allow you to bank. So they do have that now in Colorado. There are, and they do know what those businesses do. So that is one positive thing. As California gets into regulation, I think you'll see that noose will loosen up a little bit, and they'll take it more serious. You know.
Yeah, I agree, Tony. This is all going to change rapidly because they want control, not less control. So banking will be the next step, you know. And the only other thing I have to say with credit unions, though, guys, is go look up the Rhode Island banking crisis of 1991, because all of us people in Rhode Island woke up to 45 credit unions closing that did not have FDIC insurance. And I had two bank accounts at the time, both of which were frozen. Assets were not anything you could get at. And it was a nightmare. And I don't know. It changed my faith in banks, to be quite honest with you both. I mean,
well, why am I saying banks? Is because of this taxation. With this taxation, they want us to go pay these taxes, but I can't pay these taxes without a bank, which means I have to go, and other people have to physically go risk their own selves taking the money to the tax man in cash, and that's bullshit. You know, we should be able to have armored cars or at least have money transfers and things like that, as opposed to having to, already the risks we already take, have to take other risks on top of that.
Well, and you should have full integration with the e-commerce. You should be able to take all the Apple Pay and credit cards and everything, like not have to even deal with cash all the time. Like,
that would be nice.
Yeah. Well,
I think there's like called racketeering and some other things. Todd might want to chime in on what the legal
don't forget money laundering.
No, this is called a regular commerce. I mean, and that's what we all really have to start understanding, is we really are now fighting a civil rights and equal rights game. This is not just about, can I have my pot? I'm sick. I have cancer. Stop beating me. This is about, no, treat me equally. How have you been treating the tobacco producers? How have you been treating the alcohol distributors?
It really depends on who the attorney general is, because if they want to be really dickwads and say Trump was president and his projected attorney general, he said he'd go after it.
Well, yeah. Truthfully, this is why I think people, especially in the United States right now, should be supporting guys like, you know, Bernie Sanders, the only candidate up there saying that he would deschedule cannabis. He would treat it like any other thing. I mean, there are people that know the truth, and then all the corporations, fucking lackeys, that are still making money off the status quo. And I dare I say that's what we've been fighting this whole fucking time, are people that are making money the way it is. And now, that includes pot doctors, pot clubs, and pot growers, because they don't want to see legalization either. So
I think the worst is cannabis magazines. They're the biggest profiteers, right?
High Times?
No, I was thinking of XXX.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's all about disseminating money. It is funny, though. You look at High Times, and everybody gives them the beacon of greatness. And what have they? Have they ever thrown down for an initiative? Have they ever supported anything other than themselves ever? I mean, I say that like Sean Parker's coming in, this big guy, but how long has High Times been a multimillionaire? They've never, not one initiative that I know of, and correct me if I'm wrong.
They started out as a cocaine magazine.
Right, well, or Normal, the great National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws. Where have they been? They haven't run an initiative, and they've been around since the 70s.
They didn't start as a cocaine magazine. They started as a pop magazine and got into coke when everybody else did.
Yeah, over big
piles. But regardless, I mean, they've made a ton of money off of cannabis the past 20-plus years. Cannabis cups, you know, going to Amsterdam, the whole industry, Hemp Times, not $1 has gone into any progressive social change. I mean, and I'm not saying that companies have to be obligated to spend their money any way they want to, but we've all sat around and given our time to this industry, really just given our time to this industry, whereas other companies have come in, made a ton of money, and they don't give any of their effort to helping make the world a better place. They're just making money off the status quo. And that's a bummer.
I don't think they're stone cold. It's more gray than, you know, white and black. I mean, they do support cannabis, but yeah, they don't.
Come on, you've seen Michael Kennedy's Long Island mansions. I mean, the guy was an obnoxious fucking New York attorney.
No, you know? I agree with you. I can't disagree with you.
Right.
But at the same time, it's what we have.
Well, you know what? It was pretty much High Times that inspired Mark to do cannabis culture and just make it like the exact opposite. Just be like, I'll use this magazine to make an enormous amount of profits, and then I'll just give it all away to the
community, to the, like, paying activists to be activists back in the day, hiring tons of people, running
the very first issues, I think I've got them. Weren't they really a seed catalog with a little magazine wrapped around them?
Well, before the seed catalog, it was Cannabis in Canada. And it was just kind of like, it was in between the magazine that it would become and sort of one of the inspirations locally that was operated by a Jamaican guy by the name of Brother Leroy. And he had a little tiny guide thing that was like the Hemp Times, I think it was called. And it was just a little sort of pamphlet with like 10 or 15 pages, and it had little articles in it and different places where you could, you know, find the pot community in Vancouver. It was really cool, and that's, you know, it was made to be a full-size magazine, the first Cannabis in Canada.
He had one of the first kind of issues in the days from it.
Yep. Yeah, there was earlier ones, even earlier than that, that didn't even, that one actually looked more like a magazine, even pre that one too. Yeah. It's a paper cover, and it looks really more like what it is, which is photocopies of I guess how they created it. I'm sure you probably have the original one there too, or Dana Larson, who I invited in today.
Definitely.
Yep.
Some of the earlier copies just right beside me. I know I got a few more downstairs. I've been collecting this stuff for years. I got my own mini museum, you know, that I got little bits and pieces everywhere. It's been a big part of my life and my culture, you know. So that's always good to have this stuff around.
I think we all should start, like, we as a community, that is, really do have to look at changing federal law, though. I mean, this is something that absolutely positively has to happen. Whereas the states are helping us, the federal government has to come around and accept the science and make the scheduling changes and the federal guidelines changes. The Code of Federal Regulations has to be fucking rewritten. The drug war was a fucking farce, and it was a failure and a money grab, and they have to see it for what it is now. I mean, and I don't know how to be, you know, so... Because there's no simple solution, you know, how do we approach these congressmen and senators, but there's really not that many of them. You know, if we look at this in a sense, like, we have to educate our congress members and our senators and our elected politicians on a federal level, really that's what we have to do. I mean, we as a community, that is. You know, I thought before, I wish I had the cash, I would send every sitting member of Congress an Emperor Wears No Clothes and a copy of the Union. Well, now the culture high too, but, you know, any suggestions are greatly appreciated.
Well, you know what? It has been a huge failure, the war on drugs, from our perspective, but I guess if you look at it from their perspective, they probably think of it as a huge success. They created a giant prison complex. They have more control over an alternative group of people that they probably would like. I don't know, it just seems like from their perspective, it's been successful, just destroying lives, you know, stealing people's livelihoods right out from under them, breaking up families, jailing people, getting paid for those people through subsidies that are in prison. Like, it's all so corrupt and insane that how could anyone even ever create such a thing?
The drug war has made a lot of people a lot of money. You know, this is the same with the military-industrial complex in America right now. This money doesn't vaporize. It goes into the pockets of the people that own the armament companies that make all the shit that the NRA and the fucking government is promoting. I mean, this is why I kind of despise the stuff, the toys I grew up with as an adult, I rejected because I felt like it was just a manipulative way of trying to own me with my little toy soldiers and my tanks. And, you know, and I'm so glad I got weed and I could think for myself and see things in a very different way and move away from all of that manipulation. I think cannabis is such an emancipator. It's understated what it's done for freeing the cognitive liberty of humanity around the world.
And look at how hard they prohibit it. It shows obvious that that is a truth, and the truths go even deeper than that. It's so multi-dimensional, the amount of truths there are with cannabis and what it can open and unlock in you, that it's just, it never ceases to amaze me. It just constantly gets more ridiculous. I'm sure in 20 years we'll be like,
Actually, did you know that cannabis was responsible for the creation of the entire universe? Cannabis is God!
Yeah, huge surprise.
Well, it doesn't get said much, but you know what? When I walked through Ben's Barcelona Museum, one of the things I thought was, you know, cannabis is responsible for the cultural evolution of humanity. When you look at the invention of paper and it giving us the ability to communicate, and then you're looking at clothing and you're looking at ropes and sails and maps and books, and it's unbelievable what
or music. Cannabis, look at all the music cannabis has inspired.
Absolutely.
Say that again, Etienne.
Look at all the music that cannabis has inspired.
Absolutely.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, a lot of music, too. I mean, and nothing, not to discredit music at all, but, like, when you think of humanity getting the ability to wear clothes and write letters and then build ships and sail around and meet each other, this is all rooted in the cannabis plant. It wasn't cotton sails. It wasn't, you know, tree paper making, you know, our notes back then. It was all going back to cannabis being the origin plant of use of these things. Fucking epic, really. Cannabis, there should be big statues to cannabis in every city because of the gifts it's given to humanity and our ability to evolve around it.
It's a good one for sure. It sure wouldn't be a hard question if I asked the panel, if you were stuck on an island and you could only have one plant, would it be the flax plant or would it be the cannabis plant? I think I know the answer. With that said, I think it's time, as Baba Rob would say, to blow smoke towards the Vatican. They definitely
bong rip. Bong rip. Mother lovers.
Mother lover.
I love my mother.
I love my hash.
I love mine too.
Shout out to moms all around the world.
But do you love your mom's hash?
I wish. That would have been cool.
I don't know anybody's mom who makes hash.
Yeah, I don't know anyone's mom. So, hey, Todd, your mom ever make hash?
I taught my mom how to make hash, and she made the most sickest full melt. You guys would have been so friggin' impressed. She did it only one time. I didn't do it for her. She did it. We called it Polly's Full Melt, and it was absolute fire. Shout out to Paulette for, you know, the first and only time you ever made bubble. You produced the fire, so good on you.
And was that water hash or dry sip?
Oh, that was water hash.
So, Todd, you didn't answer, did your mom ever make hash?
No, my mom had a lot of hash, though. my mom is the one who taught me how to actually pick quality hash. She was my initial hash teacher. Because I brought hash home, and she didn't believe I had hash, and then she looked at it and was like, oh, yeah, it's pretty good hash.
Love the mom. Shout out to High Integrity Glass Art in the room, in the chat room right now, brother. Hope all is well right now.
Well, Jen Doe's a mom. She makes hash, so we know her.
I invited her in today. I sent out the link, actually, to Hillary. I sent it out to Jen Doe. I actually sent it out to Samantha Elvey, one of our past guests on Hash Church. She used to come on a bit. I wanted to find out how she was doing.
There's, like, not a cloud in the sky, and I think all the ladies are outside suntanning on the beach, at least here in B.C. It's gorgeous outside.
Must be clear all the way to Amsterdam. It's super toasty, not a cloud in the sky. It's sunny, blue.
It's a beautiful day here, and I'm not going to lie, my boat is finally on the dock. After going and grabbing it over a month ago and letting it sit on my front yard for a month, I put it in the water the other day, and, you know, boating is a funny thing. It can drive you nuts. It is truly breakout another 1,000, or in the ocean's case, it could be breakout another 10,000. But boats truly are medicinal in the sense of how they detach you from the land, and you're just out in this vessel floating on the ocean. An ocean that, you know, we have humpback whales or blue whales and killer whales, dolphins, sea lions, seals. Like, there's a lot of bigger creatures in this ocean out here. When you're on the boat, you can see these things. It happens, and it's just an absolute, such an amazing blessing to just be able to hang out on the boat for an hour or two at a time. It's truly why we spend the insane money we spend, because even if you have a friggin' little aluminum boat with a 5-horsepower motor, you're still spending money on that thing.
I got an Argo with an outboard motor, and I'm thinking, I'm going to take it to the lake.
I've been in your Argo with the outboard motor while we were tearing through the forest and then just come right out into the marsh, drive through the marsh. I'm like, dude, you might get stuck, and then all of a sudden it's like we're floating, and this little motor's going. It's pretty trippy. John's Argo is maybe the trippiest, like, off-road sort of thing that you could ever really do, I think, potentially. The Argo is frightening.
It was fun. But I was just thinking the boat, and I thought, you know what, I want to go on a boat, and I was like, wait a second, I got an outboard motor.
I'll tell you one thing, dude. Your Argo potentially was the worst toy you should have been playing with back when you were told. Like, this guy would go... He takes his Argo to camping with me. I bring him to my camp with all these people that I know. He shows up with the Argo. He's given everyone Argo rides for hours. Hours he's ripping through the forest, and like it's going up and down, and it's a super traumatic experience if you've never been on one. You're banging around, and there's really nothing to hold on to. And man, how long were you crippled after that?
A couple weeks recovery. I mean, that was
2 weeks.
That was, you know, that was like 3-4 years ago. So I was doing pretty good back then. You know, it was a lot of fun.
Oh man, it was fun because
Extreme Argo Adventure with Bubbleman. That is the video on YouTube, and it is epic.
That's right. You have an Argo video. That's right.
He's like, that's right. Extreme Argo Adventure. So look that up, guys. You'll actually have a laugh.
Yeah, it's a good one for sure. That thing is traumatic. I thought sledding was traumatic, but that thing's traumatic.
Oh, it's fun. It's the scariest you'll ever be at 5 miles an hour.
Yeah, it only goes like 4 or 5 kilometers an hour, and it's terrifying.
It's the 8x8 Argo with the 8 wheels, and I got a steel track on it, so it pretty much is a tank. It goes anywhere.
I have a new game. When anyone on the panel like touches their nose or like yawns, I click the camera to show them doing that. I'm just joking.
You'd be like, "There's John dabbed out."
I've been hitting like, you know, massive amount of hasher in the background while you guys are all chatting. So I just hit some like of this. Leroy cookies. I just finished it up. Just Leroy cookies, turprise, and that was it's really heavy. Like it immediately makes you tired. And I was amped up, and I've had coffee, and I apologize.
Don't apologize.
I'm super hot.
I thought this was hash church, so I just got carried away, I guess, in the background.
Well, here's a nice story. Recently, I was at a couple of months ago, I was at my store. And I was in the back having some meetings, and then those meetings ended. And there was a gentleman in the front. I have kind of a little storefront, but we keep the door locked. We don't operate it as a storefront, but you're able to come and make you can come and make an appointment and look at, in the storefront if you want, or just come and knock on the door during business hours. Anyway, this gentleman was out in the room, and he saw me puffing, actually. And we started talking, so I invited him into the back for a little puff, and he was like a BHO guy. He was learning about water hash, so I had full melt on me, I had some dry sift, I had some rosin. I smoked the gamut with this guy, utterly destroyed him, sent him on his way. The next time I go to my office, there's a handwritten letter from this guy saying how much I changed his life, how he bought dry sift screens. The next day he came back and bought these screens. And then he brought me dry sift. And I'll tell you, man, for this guy's first dry sift, this shit is incredible. Like 6-star, melts right through the screen, turns to liquid, and has a beautiful bouquet that almost only dry sift can have. It's so just on point with, I guarantee you, the flower that this guy is making.
That's what we want to hear.
Well, and... I'm going to say, the other day I was like, I have this like Apple TV. It's the first time I ever got any kind of cable. I got DirecTV because they blend your they blend your phone bill now with the cable, and they gave me like unlimited North America everything. But I didn't realize this, but it was like I'm sitting there and I'm like, oh, I'm hooked up to Netflix and all this different stuff on there, and then there's YouTube. And it's just like the light bulb that goes off with technology when you realize you could pull up YouTube and watch your Bubbleman dry sifting videos and different kind of videos right there on the whole TV, just off a little Apple TV that's hooked up to the internet, you know, instead of going through the computer. So I know most people are already like doing that shit, but I just haven't been into TVs.
I'm all over that as a photographer. Apple TV allowed me to project my photos through slideshows onto the TV, so it's great.
Yeah, I was just like, wow. Then now I get it. This, I was like, this is what everybody else is watching. So I saw, you know, Ash Church was on there, and it was like easy to pull up some of your other videos I was looking at, just because I have this sift box, this thing that you sent out. Let me show you this thing. I wanted to learn how to use it, so I have it on my now. I have it on my TV. I just pulled up the. I just pulled up the YouTube, and it was just like a good way to have a reference, you know? I don't know.
I'd love to have my mic unmuted, but my daughter's screaming in the background, and I'd rather not record it on Hash Church, so someone else will have to talk right now. Johnny's looking like he's ready.
I have a thing I want to ask Todd. Todd, did you see the list of inmates that Obama commuted this week? And again, the lack of, you know, mostly it's crack and cocaine and methamphetamine dealers. There's one guy who had a marijuana offense in there. It seems ridiculous. It seems like when he goes to commute and give clemency to guys, it's not for cannabis. It seems to always be centered around these Schedule II drugs.
Well, I can't say it's around the scheduling, I'm sure. I mean, you know, after going through the 5-year tour of the federal prison system, I can say, man, sadly, there are a lot of people that are locked up for a god-awful amount of time for things other than cannabis that I may not take, but I don't really think should be illegal. Like, and I was more upset about the limited amount of sentences that he actually commuted. And the other point that really hurt me was that, you know, so far Obama has pardoned more people than the past 7 presidents combined.
Yeah, 343 okay, so total, I think.
It's hard to say that the guy's not trying. Obviously, 7 times, all 7 last 7 presidents haven't done as many as he's done. So, okay, that to me is a great start. But you know, I think where my anger is coming from, in a sense, is bigger, is that, you know, when the drug war was going on and these sentences, these guys were locked up in the 80s for life sentences for powder cocaine and crack and stuff, we didn't have smartphones. We didn't know all of what we know now. And now that we do, shouldn't we hold the federal government and the sentencing guidelines and the Bureau of Prisons and the Justice Department and the prosecutors to a whole new level of expectation? Now that we're all so well informed about the reality of these things, and shouldn't it be a consensus in a democracy that we will no longer tolerate this abuse of justice? And, you know, I would like to see a few more, you know, zeros on the amount of people that Obama is really releasing from these prisons, because, you know, the media always points out that we have, you know, a quarter of the world's prisoners. And the truth is a lot of these people, a lot of our neighbors were not locked up for being violent. They were locked up for breaking the drug war, the drug laws. And it's just a war on some drugs. So it's a hypocritical, bigoted war that really we have to rethink. And the Global Commission on Drug Policy is leaning on the United Nations. And I think that we need to start looking at this as more matter of fact. And that's why I think I say over and over again, we only have so many congressmen, we have only so many senators, and the executive branch is not that big. I mean, you know, this is now a position where American people could actually vote for some, you know, crazy guy like Bernie Sanders who's making a ton of sense and fucking maybe end the war on drugs, maybe deschedule cannabis, maybe change this whole fucked up system that I don't see changing under any of the other assholes because they're all part of the problem, you know? So, you know, I don't want to bag on Obama because I think he's done more than the last seven presidents combined to try to reverse some of the fucked up situations that we're facing as prisoners in our own country, you know. So, yeah, I hope more can be done. You know, that's kind of how I feel about it. I was reading it, too, and I was just more astonished that he'd done more than the last seven presidents combined.
Well, that said, they have over 9,000 requests for clemency at the Department of Justice now. So the fact that
that's nothing. You know, when I was in prison, fuck me, in 15 years ago, it was literally we crested 2 million prisoners. And, you know, at the time, there was like between 160 and 200,000 prisoners in the federal system, I believe, reading. And, you know, now the numbers are higher. And it's not because of terrorism. It's not because of some Joe's, you know, robbing a bank. It's because of bad drug laws. And I think that a lot of our resources are wasted with these drug wars now that we're starting to see, you know, other problems. You know, terrorism, you know, the mall blowing up, fuck, that's a problem, you know. But if you're busy, you know, using the two cops you have to chase around some kid with a bag of weed and another with a sheet of acid, we're screwed collectively. So I hope this all gets rethought, and I hope the drug war gets kicked out, and I hope, you know, drugs get regulated to a degree. I don't think all drugs should be legal. I don't think that little backyard meth cooks should be allowed to whip up whatever they want and sell it to their local neighbor's kid. I certainly don't think that should be reality, you know, but I think also if you create a system where drugs are legally available, there won't be a need for people to counterfeit what is otherwise cheap and, you know, pure sources of whatever garbage it is they want, you know, from heroin to fucking tobacco, none of which I'd use, you know what I mean? But, hey, what are we going to do, start taking away people's tobacco because they can't do it themselves?
I wouldn't mind putting them in a little room with some exhaust fans going and me not in that little room, but yeah, you gotta have your choices.
Well, you know, though, it's an American thing on a lot of levels, because when Columbus landed here, he found a plant that he didn't know existed, which was tobacco, and he couldn't find the plant, cannabis, that was responsible for his ropes, his sails, his cloths, his maps, his Bibles, and everything else he needed. So tobacco was a huge pivotal part of the development of North America, and it's amazing the hypocritical stance between some drugs like LSD or cannabis or cocaine and tobacco and alcohol.
True. Where's your email, Tony? Rocking that torch. Looks like he's rocking the Joe Halen trough.
That's trough.
It's a trough. Fire in the hole.
I just been, I don't want to have to plug in another thing. Everything around me is plugged in. I just wanted to go analog, you know?
Yeah.
And I find that the taste is really good on a big course like that when I'm doing a little, getting a little bit of this stuff.
Just pour it in.
You guys going to watch me or are you going to join me? I mean, D420. D420, where you at?
He's like slumped over in his chair.
Yeah.
His head's all leaned back.
Well, now that we know his full story.
My dad showed up, bro. Coffee.
Nice.
Dad.
Double dip.
Hi. Double dip.
I'm going to just drip. Instead of a double dip, I'm just going to drip it. This is how you clean the end of it.
Oh, that looks like it's not moving very fast, but I guess the glass will heat up a bit if you just drop it right into the trough.
Nice yawn speak, Bubble Man. That was well recovered.
Here we go.
You like that?
Dipping. Ripping.
Bog ripping.
Here it comes.
Johnny! Ripping the ball rig.
Here it comes. Come on, drip, drip.
Oh, can you rip it on
drip, dip. Pipe? And we got the rosin and the sift with the terp and then back into the bubble.
That's a triple
dip. It was a quadruple dip because it had that.
Quadruple dip. Quad dip.
Quad factor.
You can feel the terp hit in the beginning and then it goes through the dry sift and then the bubble and then the rosin at the end.
Wow. So this little thing, like, the little vial fits perfectly in my shovel and it doesn't fall out and it just melts everything in there.
There's some nice bubble right there. Quartz,
maybe we could get quartz jars that you fill and that just insert into a special, you know, kind of like that, but with a little less of that sort of that back and forth thing's making me nervous.
Well, it can't come out. It's positioned and it just like, it's amazing because it just warms up and it just drips right onto the shovel. It's like imagine when you were like a kid and you were playing with the Tonker toy.
Someone will have a new name for it tomorrow with the word tech at the end of that name, and they'll start the hashtag, and it'll be theirs. They'll fight with you 3 years from now and be like, dude, I started that hashtag, bro.
Done.
Last Church Man recorded history.
I just did it.
Last Church 89. Check it out.
Last Church 90 next week. Excited for Last Church 90. We're going to get the Bizarre Brothers in here. Maybe Jordan, too.
Morning. Yeah, we can definitely get them in. I'm gonna try to do them, and I guess I'll try to do. We'll see. A couple guests.
Absolutely. Grip tech, bobble tech, ninja tech,
floor tech.
Yep.
Shoulder tech.
Vial tech.
Ab tech.
Peeled tech. Field tech.
Field tech?
Getting
field tech. Tech.
Hashtag tech.
So what's everybody smoking on right now? What are you guys toking on?
I got this beautiful rosin. Then I have this amazing sift. Followed by this really good bubble hash. And then I got some more sift with, of course, some terps.
That was one hit? Was that was one hit?
That was one hit. The way the flavors hit. Now I'm dabbing at like I'm at 610. So yeah, I'm a little bit lower, but I like a little bit hotter. But that was tasty. It was like.
What are you toasting on there, D?
Well, I've got one rig set up at 525 for some real low temp terp dips, and some West Coast Concentrate Boys water hash, some of this high grade extracts that was given to me at the Toronto Expo, and some of this lemon kush or something like that. They've got some very nice gear all over the place. And a dip into the red Congolese. So I might as well dip it up and do it, quad factor it like Johnny, because that's just...
I'm on the third pull right now, rosin.
Just the way we roll.
Are we curb dipping? Bond dipping? Double dipping? Quadruple dipping?
Quadruple dipping.
Quadruple dipping into the terps.
Straight tripping?
Boom.
Straight tripping. This one might hurt.
Like hash trip Sunday, time to relax and just enjoy.
Ooh, red Congolese.
Red Congolese. You know what? I'm going to step it up one more notch. I'm going to add a little bit of Medi Kush dry sift. That this is going back to Mark probably a couple years. This is wow. Like, yeah. So I'm going for number five, Darrin. Boom.
You know what? I'll do the same and a lot of the concentrated X's hash.
Nice.
To the factor. What's after quad?
To everybody on Hash Church 89.
Nice shear on.
Wow, what's that?
I'm calling this the Muhammad Ali because it's a knockout method.
Muhammad Ali.
Shout out to Muhammad Ali. We haven't even shouted out the champ.
Hey, that's a fact. This dab should be for Muhammad Ali, the legend, the champion. Everybody's training techniques, all the hardest stuff, fighting underwater, doing everything was from him originally, man.
Not to mention, his expertise rang outside of the ring. He got into politics. He got into, like, he made some heavy statements back in the day, not knowing the future, what the future would hold, not fighting in the Vietnam War was pretty heavy. I'm not going to go kill yellow people for white people.
In his prime.
Yeah, yeah. It's
why he's in his prime. He could have had four more bouts in those years.
It stripped him of his title too. He was the Olympic champion in 1960.
And remember what he said about dabs? It stings like an E and makes you float like a butterfly.
Fly, yeah, float like a butterfly, sting like a bee.
Butterfly, sting like a bee. There's a big poster on D for 20K when you walk in his apartment right there.
It says, I'm so fast that I once turned out the light in my hotel room and I was in the bed and under the covers before the light was out. Muhammad Ali, bong rip to you, brother. Thank you for what you taught me.
The five dabber, I'm recovering.
Adam Simpson. I like when people they got their point that they want to get across, but you don't really like reply to them right away, so they just keep saying it. So he's been asking about 10 gallon bags, and so just now he wrote, Ali would make 10 gallon bubble bags. That's a good one, Adam. That's, I appreciate when it's done in humor, you know. It's not a grind then.
That's a respectful dig.
That's a respectful.
I got a couple quotes up here. We should read a couple more of his because they are pretty good, and he is somebody not to be overlooked. There's a list here. It's not bragging if you can back it up. He's got don't count the days, make the days count. That's one of my favorites.
Yes.
And impossible is temporary. Impossible is nothing.
How about I'm so pretty?
Yes.
I'm so pretty. I'm so fast. I'm pretty. World. Yeah. Muhammad Ali.
Hash Church. What a chill Hash Church today. We've gone a couple hours in. We really haven't kind of talked a little bit about politics and a little bit about Ja Herbs, but it's just been a real kind of chill, lazy Sunday afternoon. I don't know what the weather's like where all of you guys are, but it is going to be spectacular Jamaica weather here today. I guarantee you we'll be in the 90s.
I put my plants outside, the ones that I have left, a few of them. Six.
Yeah, it's beautiful out there.
They're now the outdoor crop for the year.
Man, that red Congolese dab was intense. It was intense. Grabbed me by the throat. It had cured out quite a bit. I left the jar open a little bit, and it really kind of thickened up. It was intense. Jamaica Queens.
Mine was the red Congo Turp dip. Very intense as well. The last one was great.
What's going on in the chat? You guys have any questions that you want answered or that you'd like to see this conversation directed in a certain direction? Perhaps you have a question. If you do, type it out. We'll do our best to answer it. Sometimes there's great questions that come out of the chat and really inspire a great conversation.
How many people are watching right now, Mark?
There's 853 people watching right now that we can say hello. Jaden9898 asks, can we sponsor Hash Church? So we're really doing the sponsorship thing for Hash Church.
Okay, people want to know about my spiders. Bugs.
What about...
I cut down the whole crop, as you know. It's gone. I left one plant to test a bunch of products with that I've been playing with for the last few days. Then the room is being completely redone, and I'll be doing it by a lot of suggestions that I've talked to with people on the panel here, suggestions in my chat room, on my channel. So I'm definitely taking it and redoing everything and going on, you know, next step.
So let me ask you something about that, John. Last time I hadn't been following you for a minute. You were switching to all LED. Are you still growing that way?
What I'm doing right now is I'm running two Gavitas on one side with the plasma in the middle. On the other side, I'm running the Endomax 315s with the new bulbs, and then I'll throw another 150-watt bulb with the LED in the middle. So I've cut my hydro bill down by about probably 65% from the original room. I'm getting really good growth, but I did have that bug problem. It's just I did not want to spray in flower. I caught it at the beginning stages. I tried adding predator mites and ladybugs in those stages. At that point, I was too late, so learning from my lessons, I cut it down and redoing things, and I'll be adding certain things before going into flower now, taking some suggestions from people I've talked to and stuff like that. So, of course, it's a good learning experience for myself and, of course, for the other people that are following me to see the mistakes that I've made and the reasons why it happened and reasons why I did not want to use these other sprays and stuff on my plants and those stages of flower because I don't want to smoke in my hash.
Yeah.
Pretty much, right? I mean, this is what you should
do. Correct.
Right, so that was exactly what you said, Sam, and that's what I took the advice, and I took those steps because this is what you need to do, and you know a lot of people wouldn't do that, but I didn't want to spray anything on there, and I tried lowering humidity, lowering temperatures, raising humidity. I tried certain steps to help in that manner, but you know what? So cut it down, learn from what I've done, next step, and you know what? That's what we're gonna do. I won't get them next time. I assure that. I'll be going in with full suits. I'll be changing, going inside the room. I've cut down the plants going outside, like the roses and stuff. All these things come into a factor, going underneath in my grapes, so walking around the other way. There's little things that I can take to ensure that I don't get bugs, and there's steps that I have to take for that. So, yeah.
I like how you share all the ups and downs.
You have to. I can't hide it. This is exactly what happened. I mean, I even I've talked with the guys from Green Planet, the owners, Justin and stuff. Like, I never had bugs, and then all of a sudden I've been having it for the last year and a half, and it's just been I haven't taken the proper steps to fully clean the room, and I took it for granted, and now I have to deal with it properly, even from the rebuild of the room and stuff. It was the outside of the room and what I was bringing into the room, along with people and stuff. So, you know what? It's good to learn.
Bugs are like they're like freeloaders, you know. They're like you build this epic forest, and then all of a sudden they come along, and you're starting at 100%, meaning your resin and the trichome and everything that you're growing towards is you're 100% healthy. And the second they start moving in, thrifts, they basically just start having a party on your land, and every minute that goes by, they multiply. And their party gets bigger and bigger, and then they're having topside parties, and you can like see them all like hanging out.
I'm learning, you know, I don't know, like spider mites, they're born pregnant. Where I mean, I'm talking with other people that use stink and stuff, and they actually march around the plants that are poison, so they're smart. And I was watching them on camera when I had the infestation and how they migrated and how they moved and just how everything they did. Then I hit the whole thing with Dr. Doom, and I watched them all die on a contact, and then a couple of days later, you start seeing bugs hatching again, so you can actually watch the cycle. Actually, it's kind of cool to learn from this one plant, right? That's what I want to learn. That's why I'm doing it.
Yeah,
so
well, and then
this plant.
What I was getting at is, like, you know, you start off healthy, you get thrifts, that's instant 10% gone off your yield of plant and resin, you know, and you've got to do something. So there's like sticky tape and stuff that like you could put up would attract them, and you see that. But it's this, you know, spider mites or like russet mites or different kinds of mites that come from the soil, you're literally fucked once you get them. And that's really when everyone asks me, what do you do for bugs? It's called prevention.
How about this, Tony? I've seen plants that don't get bugs because of their terpene, their smell. They have some predator. They have some sort of defense against it that keeps those bugs and powder mildews away. That I've seen other plants catch in the same room, and the other ones be totally fine. Now, is there any profiles that we could use?
Yeah,
dirt or some type of tree?
The first thing that we'd need to determine is, are they really truly resistant, or are they just way more resistant than the other varieties in the room? So, if there was only one variety and you put a bunch of negative bugs in there, are they going to take it because it's only that one variety?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I wonder too. But there are plants out there that deter plants like geraniums or something like that, or there's you introduce some house plants into your room that deflect bugs.
Okay, but make sure they don't have bugs on them.
Yes, for sure. But I'm just curious if anybody knows that.
I never keep any other companion planting, and I'm really meticulous about killing every weed because they all harbor one kind of pest or another.
Mm. Exactly. Bring in plants, they bring in other bugs. So.
Yeah, houseplants.
I've seen entire greenhouses, 10,000 square feet, killed by whitefly, killed by aphids, killed by, mites is a big one. But, I've seen thrips do really bad damage. But, the key is constant monitoring and prevention before you have a problem.
Yeah.
I was using certain contact killer sprays going in the flower, which was all in my videos and stuff. Every 3 days I was spraying and stuff. But, I mean, these are the products that are out there that are available, and I still got bugs, and I didn't want to spray in the flower. I think it was you suggested I should start adding all of these predator bugs and all the biological going in the flower. In veg, not while I'm in flower.
In veg before you flower.
Exactly. So there's a key.
First of all, the predator mites for similis, they're not effective. They don't go into diapause during a short photo periods, 12 hours. But what they do is they stop hunting.
Hmm. Well, that's just as brutal.
For all practical purposes, yes.
They just stop hunting. It's like, listen, you lazy motherfuckers, you got work to do.
Well, you know what? People are saying neem oil and stuff like that. Well, spraying an oil on that plant while in flower, I'm going to taste that in my resin. So I don't want to spray absolutely nothing on my plants when the day after I go into flower. Once I see those pistillate hairs, that's showing me that I'm getting resin production. And we've seen it, Mark, even with your camera coming right out of the seed.
Even spraying on veg, you have to understand you're still coating resins. You're still spraying.
It's still there. So, I mean, it's really, that's my main focus. It's my medicine. I smoke all my resin, and I don't want to spray anything on my plants. And I want to, that's my main key importance around this. And I'm going to go back to going organic and how I've done before. It's what I use, and I might mix soils again. Who knows?
One of the big problems, John, is maintaining mothers 100% pest-free.
Yes, and I've had the same mom around since 2006. So.
But with little tiny mothers that are just, say, less than 6 inches tall, I would have nothing against dipping in a really, really strong insecticide targeted at your particular pest.
Exactly. Those leaves will all be gone.
Dip it, if you need to, 3 times a week apart. Like, that's what I used to do before I put it in the general population. And I was growing thousands of plants, and I wasn't having problems.
There you go, yeah. It's a set of, just have this, it is what it is, but learning from it again, and just the few mistakes that I did make, and just even outside of my room when I go in, I had all these pots sitting there and all the old stakes been there for, a year. Of course, just I start pulling pots out of there and cleaning it up. There's webs in there and stuff. I mean, I made my mistakes. I could see what the reasons why I had bugs and stuff like that. So.
Did you get rid of that vine that had all that powdery mildew outside of your room, that giant...
It's gone. I cut that whole tree out.
That was a major one. I remember telling you that years ago when I first...
Anybody ever had scales before?
He would walk under this pergola that was covered in this grapevine, like completely, that's how you got to the room, and it was like, at one point in time in the year, this grapevine, towards the fall, would just... mold. It would just get powdery mildew unless you've ever seen it on an outdoor plant, and I was thinking, man, that's how it's getting into the room for sure.
I got plums, I got grapes, I got roses, I got pears, I got apples all walking in there, so I got a full plus, I got all my, yeah, so you know what, I have to redo my whole route. I know that, I have to change some things. There's just a few things that I've made the mistakes, and hey, I got lazy. Well,
I learned this plant way years ago. Having a house plant in my house while it had to grow. And then when I first got bugs, I was like, where did these come from? And I, of course, found them on house plants in my house. And I was just like, oh my God. I was like 20 some odd years ago, but still, it hurt.
I've been at professional greenhouse systems where they make you change your clothes and they have a strong airflow, positive airflow. So that no insects can get into the greenhouse.
I think Tweed has one of those. I saw, or no, maybe it was a company out east. DNA posted it. They were in one of those air chambers, going into the next room. And I think it was in like New York or something. It was definitely a unique video. Yeah,
because if you're handling any plant that has mites, whether it's in a garden or just walking down the street. And they're falling on you, whatever. I mean, they're on your clothes. You don't see them, you know?
Yeah, totally. They are indeed. I like the headphones you've got on Sam I Am. That's quite, that's hilarious.
Anything for good sound.
So there's, you know, John, I was going to say that everything's about prevention and methodical in the way that you do things, you know, controlling the air quality, you know, using UV air breakdowns and closed loops versus when you're open, you know, at night. But top foliar feeding, like during veg, a lot of people that are doing indoor, they are scared to do it. You just shut your lights off for a minute and do it and let it dry. But like when you foliar feed with like just pH water low, or you foliar feed with you know, like a tea root or something, you kind of save the roots and you're able to do a kind of a natural feeding, but also defense at the same time. You know, so you want to be able to during veg like prevent everything you can, not only in your suits and how you come in the room and how you approach your air quality, but also how you approach the feeding of the plant. You know, and what kind of light you give it.
And resistant varieties will become more and more important. Yeah. Eventually, there'll be marker genes for resistance to specific. I mean, they've already done this with grapes, with potatoes, with, you know, with lots of crops, and cannabis will be next.
Mm. Yeah, Todd made a good point. Acid water sprayed for bugs and alkaline sprayed for molds. You know, it's simple things that you could do in prevention. And there's nothing really, in my opinion, when you get bugs, you just get them, and there's hardly anything you can do. I've tried different torture methods, and what I mean by that is that they are contamination. And Todd's looking like torture. Yeah,
well, I was thinking torturing yourself. You know,
yeah, you could do different torture methods.
Go ahead.
Well, yeah, I was just going to say real quick that, like, if you're in a small room, you know, crank that. When the lights go out, that's when they party. So the second the lights go out, in about 15 minutes, the bugs come out and they're partying. And if you had a small room and it was really closed and you were very well insulated, you could choke them out, you know, with high volumes of CO2 and undercurrents and try to flood the room out. There's ways to do it, like if you drop the temperature, if you could do that in your room and you could freeze them out, like torture, you know, like gas them with CO2, keep it cold for different increments. And but
ultimately, all of those methods, I gassed, I had high CO2, I lowered the temperature. I brought my humidity up to 85%. All they did was make these big webs around everything. So, and then it was like, you know, all said and done, I lit a can of Dr. Doom fogger out just to, because the room is done. I'm going to wipe the whole room down with some auto bleach, and then from there I might use some H2O2 on the floors. And, you know, I'm going to do a few different things, but I'm going to get the room all nicely.
So you were basically breeding for bugs. Your garden was designed for bugs.
It was designed for bugs.
You just grew, like, they came in, they started partying, they took over, and now they own your land.
Yeah, they couldn't leave. They're just like, we can't get out of here, so we're just staying. So I'm like, fuck. So
yeah, that's what I mean. Like, it's hard once you get them. They're just, unless you use chemicals, it's like you're not going to get rid of them. You know, yeah, so the prevention's the best way.
Pyrethium and the Dr. Doom, and you know, it's something that is a contact killer. I put it off in the room. From there, I'm cleaning the whole room, wiping everything down. There's different methods. There's a few different things that people have put in my comments that have made some suggestions. You know what? I kind of know what to do. So it's just a matter of I just got to clean everything up and just be a little bit more smarter about going into my room and you know, straighten up my techniques a little bit. That's all it was. It was being lazy. That's what it comes down to.
Once you have spider mites, you can never get rid of them, but you can still control them so that they're not really economic damage. But things like white flies and aphids, you can control them 100% even after you get them.
Hmm. Why do you say you can't get rid of the spider mites, Sam?
Because they never eat every single pest, the predators. No matter how many you put on, they don't eat every single pest.
Okay. Oh, I understand what you're saying in that sense.
They're like, you know, the house guest that most never of the leaves.
Gardens I've seen, I feel that people are lazy and that they don't promote good practices. You know, they contaminate their rooms. They show their rooms to their friends who are growers. You know, they do everything to contaminate the situation, and they do very little to keep the thing spotlessly clean. I mean, when you see these pictures of the guys suited up in the, you know, the tweed factories and stuff, it's not because they want to look good in photos. It's because it's just one more step towards, you know, letting people in, but hopefully they don't contaminate what you're doing. And I think that even little growers have to start looking at this a little more, you know, realistically. If they want a clean garden, you've got to have a clean space and you've got to not contaminate it once you have it clean. It doesn't seem crazy, but so many people do everything wrong, I think.
Yeah, I painted the floors. I did everything, but I mean, I made some mistakes, and now I got a good room to clean. It's easy to clean my stuff because of the extent that I went into the room. I had a good run before that. It went very good. At the end, I was getting bugs, and of course, going into flower again, it was trying to be preventative. But you know, when I made some wrong steps, it's definitely learning. And once again, going into flower, not spraying, is what we have to not do. And that was my most important part of all this grow, was not spraying on the plants. So, you know what? That's what happened.
I was able to grow thousands of plants every year for years in the same greenhouse for decades with never using chemical sprays other than the dip I just talked about to little, little tiny clones just so that I could bring them into my greenhouse.
There you go. So that's exactly how.
A lot of times I wouldn't even plant those. I'd plant them, but I'd grow them, and then if I wanted to flower one off, I'd take a cutting from the little tiny one that got dipped when it was a little tiny one, when it was grown up big and a mother. And so you're talking about parts per trillion or something.
What was the dip you used, Sam?
Well, it depends. Usually what I was looked, because I can see most pests, but spider mites you can't see, so we used to use Floramite. There was another one we used to use. I think it was called Torque. I don't even remember the names anymore, but Floramite was what we were using against mite at the latest. And that's in the Netherlands, I think you can still buy it, but you have to have taken a controlled spray class to be able to handle it and buy it legally.
So yeah,
it's a nasty one.
There's that we were talking earlier in the chat about the different terpenes that are produced by other plants that would help with defending that, and people that use rosemary or different stuff on their flowers. That also does come out in the extract too. And some people that have autoimmune or asthma conditions can maybe if they're allergic to rosemary, it could be dangerous too. So there's all kinds of like things that you could do, and there's always
terpenes have been used experimentally for all kinds of pest control. So anything's possible. That's for sure, Tony.
Yeah, you could take like what we post here is journal, and that's what's from geraniums. Maybe put that with a particular pH water and use an atomizer that's like a fogger.
If it was up to me, I'd use red Congolese.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, but those aren't insecticides, right? Those are insect repellents, right? Those are those are just repelling the insects, so it's just going to push them over to wherever you have less repellent. So it may push them from one plant to another. You're not going to kill them. Where the stuff that Sam's talking about is actually a really potent insecticide. Oh,
it's a nasty, nasty poison.
Yeah, it's bifenthate. I didn't know that that's what it was.
You have to wear a mask,
right?
A complete suit, gloves, just to mix up a bucket full for dipping clones in. Not even spraying it, but you've got to have really good filter masks.
Yeah, yeah, it's a nasty molecule. It's something that's not approved for non-food
greenhouse, except for I used it to dip plants that I want to be 100% sure were safe. So well, I used it in a very minimal way.
You know, and this is why I say prevention, you know, because once, like Sam says, once you have them, there's not much you can do that's not going to affect the outcome. But this is also why I choose making bubble hash and then making that into a rosin rather than a flower rosin, just because, you know, bugs aren't going to if you do have some bugs there, they're not going to make it through the screening process, you know?
Well, we talk a lot about this at the Hydra store, and we believe a lot of the bugs, they come with the soils, like the pro mixes that we get. They're coming from outdoor, big storing areas. It is soil. I mean, what's coming in that soil?
We get it. I completely agree with that. Contamination is coming in. The more organic we are, the more problems we have.
And all of a sudden, we're like, we got bugs. Well, where do you think these bales of dirt came from? I mean, they're not baked. They're not coming out of an oven directly delivered to you. So there can, you know, and I mean, there's certain steps, that, like even like mixing soils and stuff like that is what I got to get into. And
you know the little jiffies? I planted seeds in them. I got a case of them before. And what happened was is like these little worms were coming and starting to eat the little seeds. And I couldn't believe it. I did an internet search. People all over the world having the same problem with these little things because they came in a whatever, they got contaminated in some way, and when you rehydrate them, it wakes up this little parasite that's in it. You can look it up, and it unbelievable. So I had to throw all of them away. They were all garbage, you know.
I've used those hundreds of times. I never got little worms, but maybe it was just one batch that got contaminated.
So I mean, this is a lot of the problems we have. We pick it up when we buy the soil, and then they give us all these pesticides and stuff that to use that are only contact killers. So I mean, we're not getting rid of bugs, and they expect us to spray all the way through flower, and then they tell us that it's okay to spray. I can't believe they're like, oh, it's okay, it's residual, it'll wash out.
Well, you got to remember, for them, it is okay.
Spray the stuff on my flowers, and I'm telling you. Where are you kidding yourself? You could take all these products that I have, everything they offer on the shelf, and they tell me I could spray the stuff on my plants, and I can consume it later. And it's just wrong what they're doing, and it's all that's offered to the community right now for bug control. It's just all these chemicals, and I work at a hydroponic store, and I'm left with really no options, and sitting here talking to you guys about it. High pH water spraying down the walls, people with sed, getting foggers, using H2O2.
Well, you said two things that were a little off, like high humidity is going to help breed the bugs, and like the pH usually would be down, not up. So
low pH. See, here's the little things. That's what I'm curious about. Right? I'm like, high pH maybe for powdery mildew, but I mean for bugs, you're saying low pH.
No. So the pH of the water you're trying to control as a preventative. So they have atomizers. They have ultrasound fogger atomizers things that you can plug in, and it does an amazing job because it breaks into little tiny particles, and you can get underneath all the plants, leaves, sticks, everything in the whole room gets fogged out. It's really easy. And this is all prevention. So you would want to have a pH on your plant, of your plants like 7. So it depends on what you're using it for, if you're using it for prevention. And if you already have powdery mildew, just like bugs, you're fucked.
No, I don't.
You know,
light everything right now. So, my room, so I don't bring
it. It starts with the clones, you know, and you have to, and you're over there. You have to be very firm in the selection of the soldiers that you're gonna have, you know. And if you have a weak one, or if you have one that looks a little sick, you're like, oh, I'm gonna nurse that one back. You're already starting below 100%. You know, now if that one was sick, and you're like, I'm gonna nurse it along, you know, that's.
Right, so if you're weak, if you can't make it, you're cut, and that's exactly the way you should treat the garden in your rent.
Yeah.
Well, certain varieties, you learn with experience that they're susceptible to mildew.
Oh, yeah.
Like anything with some Afghani.
Like Darrin said, if all of a sudden one is just like, boom, blooms like PM and the whole room's fine and now you're fucked, you'll never grow that one again. That one's cut, you go right over to the mother, pull that, you know, girl right out and kill it.
Or grow it in Afghanistan, where it's from. Or maybe the Atacama Desert in Chile. There's no such thing as a bad plant. We just need to, you know, find a good place for it.
So someone asked that question earlier in regards to what they thought the importance of growing particular in particular areas and what kind of successes we'll see, and I guess that's really the answer right there. You'll see less of the negative attributes that you might see to these Afghani strains that are being grown in, say, the Pacific Northwest, which is just powdery mildewville, and they just can't fight it or push it back at all. They just seem to attract it almost.
The easiest example is all the varietals in wine all around the world. I mean, it's the same thing will happen with cannabis once it's legal all around the world.
Mm. I'm sure certain terpene profiles that we find are important will just be like other essential oils, grown to perfection and maybe better or easier or more accessible in certain areas, at certain elevations, in certain soil mixtures with that particular sun profile. So many variables, really, but I mean, it's said to be true for other essential oils that there are...
The French used to win all the wine contests. Now the Australians, the New Zealanders, mm-hmm. the Californians, you know, all kinds of people are producing the best of a certain kind of wine.
True. Probably because they started creating their own, bred their own grapes rather than tried to grow those same ones that the French were winning with all those years.
No, I think they are the same grapes.
Just the same grapes, just French varietals that they've taken to Australia?
They grow elsewhere, correct.
Cool. Very interesting.
Well, people are saying marigolds for bugs and stuff like that, but once again, do I want to put marigolds in my grow room as I'm growing my medicine? No, it could bring in more bugs, so... Probably not.
I would not suggest it. In an outdoor garden, it might be well worthwhile trying.
Yeah, that would make perfect sense. Outdoor garden doesn't hurt to have planted around plants and the bottom and stuff like that.
Since you're into supplemental light, like having the UV, having a supplemental UV light itself in there would help control any kind of mold spores and PM and.
Well, it's funny you say that because I didn't use the UVC light in this grow yet. I wasn't using it every day where I was the last couple ones, and I was able to maintain it. I had no problems where this one here, a couple things that I'm realizing I did not do, and made it played into exactly how it played out to the end of me just cutting it down instead of spraying on it.
Do you also think that the spectrum, like, are you lacking like a red or orange spectrum in the garden because you're doing what, Gavitas and plasmas? Because those also help boost immunity and different types of support too. The plant thrives on it.
I could see underneath the plasma and the Gavitas, like the growth in that plant, you could see how healthy it was. Like the other side took on the bugs first, and that was on the corner where the LED was, and it kind of spread towards the Gavita, and the Gavita were the healthier plants. Mind you, it was two different seeds, same strain, right? So one was a little weaker just by seeing it in the growth and how it was in the room. So it was like the weaker strain took it on first, and it just kind of spread from there.
And this is all documented, this party?
Oh, yeah, it's all on video, the whole thing, all the way through, from me spraying and stuff like that, going right away through to me just cutting it down.
Bro, like, there was millions of bugs that were like, Johnny yeah. Bees, he's throwing a party! It's
I waited for 9 days, and I just left it, right? I hit it with doctor. I went away and came back, and I walked into the room and went, okay, this is what happens when you go away for 9 days.
From the place, Tony. You know that, like, look, you guys lock up when you leave.
He comes back. You should see the video. Like, you're gonna see it. Like, they're like, they're migrating to the end, like where there's a little bit of moisture left, and they're taking it back. And, like, the colony and how smart these guys work and how they're doing things in there. I was just like, wow, I've never done that before, right? I let it go because I wanted to learn for myself just to see a couple different things. I never have before. I've never been that, why not? It's like, why not? You know, let's just take a look. And it's like, it's quite amazing how they've structured around the whole buzz. They completely enclosed it. They're migrating back and forth. They're laying eggs. They've got this whole party going on. Zach, like I said, there's shooters going on over here. They got a strip club over there. You know what? They got a little school over here for education on the next steps of what to do to move down to the other
colony. Exactly. They're colonizing, dude.
They're moving the crop down, right? They're moving the whole school down to the next level to the buzz that aren't fully affected. So you can see the migration, they're actually hanging and dropping down, and they're letting go, poof, and you see them landing on the bus. Yeah, I made it. It's like jumping from mountain to mountain. It's kind of funny.
I tried using a vacuum cleaner on them once. It wasn't
effective. I'm not going to do that. I completely sprayed them down, and then I'm going to coat them with some insecticidal soap. Then I'm going to put a bag on it, and I cut it off. I take that bag, put it back there, and I pour gas on it, small fire. Fire department showed up. No, I'm kidding.
You might want to do that to the grow room.
Holy shit, that's what I was just thinking.
The grow room is completely, the way my room is set up, it's blue skin, so it's quite easy to clean. It's really taking a look at the air handler and taking a look at the old cam, pulling that out. There's different steps that I'm going to take into what I'm doing with my room because it is an easy room to clean, just the way I've built it and stuff like that. So it's just a matter of just getting back at it. You know what? Live and learn.
The mice try to overwinter in cracks, so be careful.
Try to what?
Yeah, they
overwinter in cracks.
Yeah.
Like in cracks in wood, in cracks in the greenhouse, in cracks in the ground.
You're never going to get rid of them. This is what you call blowtorch. I used to do consulting for grows and stuff.
This is
the blowtorch. This is when somebody says, what do you think we should do? And I go, take a blowtorch and blow it down and move on. Like, because it's like if you intentionally threw a topside party for your mites and they were calling all their buddies and millions were coming and they had discos going on and construction workers dropping down, and you did that in your home, they're going to hide out in the walls, man. They're going to hide out everywhere until they're ready. They're going to come back.
Well, you know, there are beetles that will hang in the walls and wait for them to come out and attack them at the same time. So there are different things that I can do to add to my room. And you know what? I'm just going to,
do this. You can watch and see. It'll all be in the upcoming videos. Over the course of the next...
I had no idea he filmed all this, though. That's what's, like, mind-blowing.
Well, I just, yeah, you know what? It was I made all the right steps, you know what? It's just interesting how...
Someone in chat said Johnny B. will burn his house down if necessary.
I think it should be called Mighty Man.
Well, that's why I thought you were moving to the waterfall area. That's what I thought it was all about because of the mite situation.
Strangely enough, Niagara Falls just had a monstrous russet mite outbreak over the course of the last 2 weeks.
No, you know what? It is what it is. I kind of just let it go for certain reasons. I didn't catch it, but at that point, I made my decisions on what to do, and that was not to spray. I made that's why I made all the steps by bringing my humidity up, lowering my temperatures down, bringing in ladybugs. I made all these steps, but I made these steps too late, and that was the problem. So learning from that, going back and making sure I don't make those same steps, those same mistakes again, is just, you know, it's a learning process, and it's good. Like, I even talked to Justin about it. He's like, you never had bugs. I'm like, I know, and all of a sudden I can't get rid of them. And it's just now I have to maintain my room to make sure that I'm able to live in harmony with them by the sounds of it. No comment.
No, I'm just, I'll check it out later. You know, this will be interesting.
Yeah, you know what? It's it's getting back into organics and getting men more into, you know, everything. People are suggesting living soils and stuff like that. That's a lot of work. So I'm definitely looking at different methods of being able to go into the next into my next grow to making sure that I have the way my stuff works. It's I have to put stuff down. I'm going to slowly start running out now just because of surgery and this one here and the failure and stuff like that. Got enough hash to last, but things have to be your mental patient, right? Pardon me?
Bigger companies like Sensi in Europe and others have used a combination of Rockwool and Hydroton very successfully because you can clean the Hydroton. You know, you can re-sterilize it just using steam and hydrogen peroxide, really. And, you know, the Rockwool you're getting is not going to have the contaminants that your soil or cocoa or other sources are coming in from. And you are only throwing away a very little bit of material, which is that little bit of rock wool attached to the root ball. The Hydroton you're, like I said, recovering and you're putting back in, and it's a very effective medium for a sterile growing environment on a professional level. And they've been doing it for like 30 years plus.
I've never been a real big Rockwell kind of guy for rooting. I've tried and always seemed to fail. I soak it for 24 hours and I got the turbo cloner. I think that's what I'm going to go with the next one is use the turbo cloner, so don't use any jiffies or anything. And then I got to establish those roots again. And
well, you could do it. Have you ever used Hydroton?
Pardon me?
Have you ever used those little round clay pellets? It's called Hydroton.
No, I have not.
It works really good. You can actually use your standard pots if you're using plastic pots. And you just can fill them up. You know, you would just have to put something as a piece. Yeah, you could actually take it out of the cloner and put it down on top and just find a way to cover the top a bit, you know, so you don't get algae build up and then, you know, drip away. Works great.
We used to eat lava rock, but then used to cut the roots as we used to move it around too much. So
yeah,
that's another hydro. It might be some place to go back to for sure.
Yeah, and I think you can control your garden. I think that if you cut everything back and you bring it down to a manageable size, like, you know, Sam was saying, you know, a bunch of little plants that you can clean and sterilize the environment and then, you know, start fresh. I mean, it's the only way I know of really kind of getting back onto the, you know, and then go in clean, you know.
That's the way I feel. That's why I did what I did, is cut it down, get rid of everything, pull it all out. Let's bring it in fresh, start by dipping new clones. And just stay on top of it right from the beginning, and adding some predator mites and stuff. Adding predators, I think in veg, even though I don't have mites, because they are going to be present somewhere. We know that they are existent, so there might be some steps I should take before going into flower this time, instead of after I'm in flower and trying to.
What we used to try to do, John, was to make sure we had absolutely no mites when we started flowering, because after flowering, you could still use, I believe it was at the time called Occidentalis californius, and they are much less susceptible to diapause under short photo periods. But the standard one, which we call here rope mite or persimilis, they're not effective once they start flowering.
And yeah, that's what you were saying there when we were talking there weeks ago and stuff like that. So I've taken all of this stuff in account and talked about it and getting all the proper things ready for next grow, right? Can't stop, never do.
At BedderCon here in the Netherlands, they close up the rooms and they don't go in them.
For how long?
The entire flowering.
Are you serious?
No, yes. I'm serious.
All on it.
It's all monitored by cameras. And I wish Jamer was here. He took the tour the last time.
I took it as well in 2011. I saw it. They do the same thing. I was stunned, actually, because, you know, they put them in the small pots.
No human contact.
And then they put them all tight into this room with a drip system and shut it in, and that's it.
Really, just let nature do its thing for 8 weeks, 10 weeks, whatever.
Yeah,
it takes.
And you see how the lights are as well, Sam. The lights are how many feet away above the actual plants themselves on top of that, because they're growing for consistency. They don't want any types of other problems, but it still doesn't keep molds and mildews from creeping in.
Yeah, but the important thing is that terpenes are not an important medical aspect of cannabis.
What about thrips? What about medical thrips?
Which has nothing to do with the fact that their irradiation process is robbing 30% of the terpenes from their cultivars.
We would get thrips almost every year because they fly in through the roof of my fucking greenhouse. Now, you can get more modern constructions of greenhouses that have built-in thrip screens, so when the windows open, they're still protected and thrips can't get through them. But, yeah, mine wasn't. So I would get thrips, but I would deal with them. And they were never an economic problem at all. But I was not a commercial cannabis producer. I was a cannabis breeder. So I have much more higher thresholds of damage is permissible.
Well, lots of good stuff to take into account. And thank you very much. Yeah, it's good to talk about it because, you know, people do have these problems, and we always walk into these hydro stores, and they always hand us this can of conch or Dr. Doom, or and they tell you to spray on the flower, and I just have problems with that. So thanks for all the advice, guys. Appreciate it.
Well, Brett Maverick said the funniest thing. He said, you can bet if they're working at a hydroponics shop, they're probably not growing the bomb.
Right. That's what I've always felt is true.
It's kind of true, you know?
If you knew how to do this, you wouldn't be here selling me soil.
Yeah, you might be at home doing, you know, what you say you can do.
I always pointed this out to people that were investors. I'm like, the people that can grow grass are not going to grow you grass. Because they're already growing grass for themselves. The people that can't pull off their own gardens are more than willing to work for you. They'll step right up, for sure.
And sell you your tomatoes. And how to grow your tomatoes. Yeah, back in the day, that's when you had to go into the grow shop. You couldn't talk about cannabis. You could only talk about as close to tomatoes.
Do you remember when George Cervantes switched from talking about cannabis to indoor underlight tomatoes and all this other stuff? He did that for about 3 or 4 years, and then he switched back to cannabis.
Right. That's when he was real paranoid, when he was wearing the wig with the dreads and stuff.
Well, he might have had his good reasons at that time. Our government was even more bizarre than it is today.
For sure. He was traveling a lot and stuff, so I hear him.
You know, I think that bugs, I shouldn't be looked at so much of it. If you're going to live in an organic situation, you've got to coexist with the creatures around you, and you just got to learn how to keep those creatures, you know, you've got to learn how to keep ants out of your kitchen and spider mites out of your garden. I mean, it's just part of, like, you're not going to go kill every ant in the world. You're not going to be able to go kill every spider mite. And if you live in some places that are warm, you can't take hikes without picking them up on your clothes and bringing them home. And if you inadvertently walk into your garden because you want to be dutiful and check it out, you just contaminated your own garden because you went on a hike and brought home the very contaminants that you hope not to introduce.
Yep, that's why some greenhouses seriously have showers, air blowers, and a change of clothes.
Yeah, we always had, we would have bleach dips outside of gardens for you to put your shoes in to step into so you could get stuff off the bottom of your shoes as well, you know, just to keep any type of contaminant out.
Yeah, microbial contamination is the real big killer. I mean, and you said before, Todd, you were talking about sterilizing. I mean, remember that the plant needs a healthy microbial population in the soil to fix nitrogen because the plant doesn't do it by itself. It needs bugs to do it. So you're absolutely true. I mean, these bugs are all, whether we could see them or not, they're all there, and they're all part of the biome. And it's difficult to think that you could somehow create an island that's microbe and bug-free to grow your cannabis in.
Right, but that said, you know what, I actually don't think that in, after doing it at Positronics and in my own world, I don't think introducing other bugs into your environment to combat the other bugs is a good idea. I think no bug shit on your supposed medicine is a better idea. And I don't care if it was a beneficial bug or a not-so-beneficial bug. I don't want to see its fucking eggs on the flower after, you know, the processing. And you know, keeping your environment clean and making, you know, sterile flowers is not impossible. It just takes work. It just takes effort. It takes a clean environment. It takes going down there and maintaining the plant leaves and cutting them back and looking for problems and taking appropriate, you know, measures, even if it's just a simple organic pesticide soap to limit their ability to propagate. There's so many things we can do if we're just doing due diligence and taking care of the shit. It really, I think problems really come when we see people not doing what it takes, being a bit lazy. I mean, the idea of closing plants in for 8 or 9 or 10 weeks and coming back like a surprise to see how the flowers came out, to me is insanity. But
well, they're doing it so there's no contamination during the process.
I can understand that, but the problem is there's also, you know, so much work.
I'm not agreeing, Todd. I'm just telling you why.
Todd, they have a window. You can actually look in through the little window of glass and see.
And there's cameras.
Yes.
If only cameras could garden. You know, but whatever. I think quality and quality do not go hand in hand, obviously.
Their motto is untouched by humans.
Yeah, maybe they'll have a drone for that someday, right?
Well, what it comes down to is you need healthy plants, healthy roots. You know, healthy roots are going to play a key role, healthy plant. I have a sick plant, I got to eliminate it, throw it out. That's the problem. Like, we always try to save that plant, like you're saying, try and nourish it back to health, and that's normally the one that slowly destroys the room.
Well, that one will attract problems, and I think this is part of the plant numbers. I think that we shouldn't have to. It's nature. You know, we have problems with bugs and stuff. I mean, this is where I think the plant numbers will be unrealistic, because a good garden really is best when you have backup plants, when you have the ability of throwing away what isn't working out. You know, if one of them was under the LEDs in the corner and wasn't getting good light and ended up being a little sickly and that's the one that got attacked by bugs, that all makes sense to me. You know, so then fucking chuck the plant and put a good healthy one in its place and put some more light and air circulation in that area and rectify the problem.
I guess I'm used to growing a lot of plants and in a greenhouse which had open roofs, so you had to have prevention pest control or you were going to get more than a little bit of shit that you might find from the beneficial bugs. I'm talking about what white flies and aphids and I mean these things they just march out of control.
Well, this will be a lot easier when the plants are not so valuable. You know, when we can afford to throw away and restart, and you know, when we can actually trade clean genetics confidently, that'll be a step in the right direction. You know,
people will also know which are more resistant to these various pests.
Technology is going to help us too, because you know, as we go forward, if we get to a place where we are, you know, getting our cultivars via cuttings we know are perfectly clean and we're able to incubate them in our, you know, own little way, you know, and this is the beginning, I think, to a whole new cannabis is going to be great with technology, I feel, because it's just a chemical marvel on a lot of levels, you know, and I look at hydroponics and the cannabis breeding as going hand in hand, because I think that a lot of the influence of the innovations that went into the hydroponic industry came from cannabis gardeners being forced to use them in clandestine operations. Tomato farming and everything is great, but the sheer profit motive is what really drove the innovation in hydroponics for cannabis cultivators. And I think that's not going to change now, especially as we get into tissue culture and just the equipment that we can utilize the technology with in our gardens. I think we're going to see a lot of these problems taken care of, you know.
Well, the few plants that I kept, I put them outside and continue to go with them, and they're bug-free and they're doing fine outside. So it's I took two and put them outside just to see how they'd work out, and you know the natural surroundings took care of the bugs.
Yeah, the UV. You know, I think a lot of the problems we have is that the lights don't produce the UV that we need, and a lot of the greenhouses block the UV. And when you put these plants outside, the sun is an amazing sterilizer. You know, the part of the problem with outside, though, then, is a bird can come by and shit on your product, which isn't cool either. So there's a trade-off on every level, you know. I mean, I like organic pot grown outside. I think it's awesome. Anyone that's ever experienced going up to a huge in-bloom cannabis plant in somebody's backyard, it's just, it's love. It's just so much great energy. I can't wait to see it everywhere, you know what I mean? But at the same time, I mean, I've seen that love in grow rooms. I've seen that love in greenhouses. You know, it's and in the inside of greenhouses, I do like the fact that the birds couldn't shit on the flowers. I think that's a good benefit. So,
I like my resin free of any type of fecal matter myself.
Just gonna throw it out there. You know what I mean?
Like, greenhouses are also really nice, Todd, when it's raining outdoors and you're standing in your greenhouse.
Yeah, yeah. So I actually think the future of high-quality cannabis will be in, you know, wonderfully technologically, you know, controlled greenhouses, you know, that have better panels than we do now that allow more UV in probably so that we actually don't have the powdery mildew issues and such that we have. I think the future is going to be great. I mean, like, we're all sitting here in different countries having a conversation on a live broadcast. I think technology is going to make the world a better place, especially when it comes to cannabis cultivation, as it has for the past 30 years.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. It's done great things for us.
I'll probably spend some time building a greenhouse this year for next year, because I think that's the next steps with what we're doing in Canada with legalization. I think I'll have no problem growing outside and having a few plants for sun-grown. I know how well it does, but here in BC, because of the weather, they never seem to finish. So hopefully with a greenhouse, I'll be able to do that.
Well, not only that, but you can build a darkening system into your greenhouse. That's pretty easy.
Yes.
You can get little small portable darkening-driven motors that are very inexpensive.
Yep, it's true. In fact, some of the greenhouses you buy, they come with ones that are custom-built for those.
Yeah, they're like awning rollers.
Yeah,
and I'm talking like a 12 by 12 or 14 by 14 greenhouse, something nice for the backyard where I can actually do all kinds of different growing in it.
If you want to have control over it with photoperiod, you want a darkening system built in.
Yeah, it's definitely taking
that into account. Something I must have to think about for sure, but I am looking at it. And something I want to do, I think it's just the next step of my journey of growing my medicine all the time. I know they're not going to be able to take away that right, so I want to make sure I'm able to access it and continue to grow it until I am old and cannot, and I'll have enough stock, or maybe by that time it'll just be like everywhere.
Boom, boom, boom.
I would say the speed of legalization is doubling almost every year.
I also can't wait to see what kind of grass we see grown in places where the climate's perfect for growing cannabis, like inland San Diego, where it's 68 and sunny. That's going to be amazing.
Or the equator. I mean, everywhere it's going to have a variety of cannabis that produces best there.
But this is what these other laws that we're talking about earlier in the discussion will spawn. You know, that's what will continue that doubling. We see, California, Nevada, and, Michigan, and, Maine start going in that direction. You're also going to see the next election more states get on board. And it's just going to steamroll until we finally reach that end of that federal prohibition, because we know as so goes the United States, so hopefully so go the UN and Canada and various other countries. So each is a stepping stone. We can't get there all at once, people. There's no be-all, end-all to this. We still have to do our part and create our change that we wish to see. Last time I checked.
I totally agree, man. Everybody, I think I'm going to jump off. It's high noon in California right now, and I think I'm going to work on it.
It is high noon on the West Coast, and I was actually just waiting for the conversation to die down so I could say thanks, everyone, for making Past Church 89 a fun episode. Got to talk about a bunch of things in regards to growing and bugs and cannabis plant that we love. Always appreciate you guys showing up for the panel. Mr. Scialdone, Johnny B, Skunkman Sam, Etienne, Todd, and Tony. We had D420K in earlier. He has since left, but we say goodbye to him as well. And, of course, all of you out there that have been watching, next week we're going to try and make it a good hash episode. Let's hope that it falls together beautifully and we get a really lovely panel in of some interchanging people over the course of the show to share their hash stories and their hash making and all things hash. We'll see you guys next week, episode 90. Peace.